Lost the channel.
Yeah, do you want to run out? Okay, I'll do it.
You want to run out? I'll run out.
Hey guys, can I get people down here? You can meet all your adoring fans.
Why can't I see the stream? I'm seeing a stupid. Dang it. Chat roll, they're so funny on chat roll.
Okay, so you'll have to. What's our wide shot?
Must have known.
Yep, you got it all.
Got everyone? Okay.
What's up? Okay, why can I not see the actual stream?
Are
you
streaming yet?
Yeah, no, we're definitely streaming. You're alive. Say hi to everyone out there. Who else do we got?
Paul's coming, Ian's coming.
Alright. Yeah, come in. Okay, all right. So this isn't actually everybody we have here because there's a few other people that are back in Austin now, but we'll be back here. Let's see. I think we can catch everyone on the big shot here. So we'll start on, this is Sandy Gardner, who I think you all know.
Hello. Where's the camera?
Which
camera, Mike? Hello?
The big one on that. Okay, this is Ian, who's our video. He's responsible for the opening sequence you saw and some of the video stuff that we've done here in LA. So he's our new video coordinator that's here in Los Angeles. This is Alan Precourt, who is our senior lighting and compositing artist, who actually comes from us. He's actually a big fan and a backer. What's that?
People are complaining about the camera angle. Someone adjust the camera.
Which, no, we're talking about the big, it's the big
camera.
The camera
is cutting off their heads. There we go.
Got it.
He's got it.
Excellent.
So, Alan is a long-time
backer fan,
and but also incredibly experienced film artist, and he's here making our lighting a lot better. So, he's done some pretty impressive projects. You want to say which ones that you've...
Lightly Frozen, go and see it, from Disney, and Avengers. Bunch.
Well, you worked on some of the wetter stuff. People probably like that. Didn't you do some Avatar work?
Did not Avatar. Did a week on Hobbit. Did Tintin. Did Rise of the Planet of the Apes and Avengers.
Yeah. There you go. So, Paul Rendell behind us is the lead game programmer on Star Citizen. So he's responsible for a lot of the overall design and structure of how the game is working, and is originally from Crytek. So, and Paul helped me back in the prototype stage, so sort of after hours, helped out, did the AI video that you guys may have saw last year, and spent a lot of his time kind of helping me do the prototype, and then afterwards said, hey, I've really been always dreaming of making a space game, so we negotiated with Crytek, and they were kind enough to let us have Paul, which was brilliant. Behind me, I have Oka, who is our graphics programmer here in Los Angeles, and you're working on the HUD stuff, which we're going to show a little bit of a video later on. So shaders, you want to say a little bit of what you're working on?
Just the shader to get the HUD to look cool in game.
Okay. It will look good.
Yes.
So caveat, we have a lot of programmers here in Austin, and programmers generally don't tend to be quite as vocal as maybe some other folks. But it's looking really good, the stuff that we're doing. So here's Chelsea, who I think you guys probably know and have met, who is heading up customer service and concierge and answering everyone's complaints today about like missing out on the Idris Corvette. Although there'll be a few more chances during the day.
Everybody wishes you a happy birthday again.
So here in the corner we have Chad, who is working on our AI. Do you want to say anything about what you're working on?
Just AI ships for dogfighting, and particularly ways to spawn AI in a sort of wave system.
Yep. So that's all cool, and partly that will be part of the dogfight module when you guys eventually get it. We'll have AI as well as the chance to go head to head with other players. Over to his side is Brandon, who is working on the UI and display part of the code, specifically in the cockpits right now. He's also being a video we'll show a bit later on. Want to say hi to everyone?
Hey, I think you're going to hear plenty from me later. So.
Okay. So down here in the front, we have Dan Tracy, who's our senior technical designer, who actually is also formerly of Crytek. You're setting up most of the stuff in the engine, the ships, the animation.
Ships, destructibility, setting up also weapons, doing layouts of the dogfighting level. You name it, I touch it. So.
Yeah. So basically, if you getting in and out of your ships, doing all the stuff that you're even doing in the hangar now, basically Dan set pretty much all that up. We would like to clone him, basically. Behind Dan is Larry, who's our new customer service QA rep. So helping Chelsea and Sandi out here deal with everything. And you actually worked with Travis before, right?
Yeah, sure did. We were at Heavy Iron THQ.
Okay.
A few
cool.
Years ago. Yeah.
And then formerly you were at Activision, and now you're
you're
coming over to the light side, away from the dark side.
That's for sure.
And then we have Brandon. Mark. Sorry, Brandon's over here.
Good
oh morning. Mark, who's basically doing gameplay in the ship systems programming. So, want to say hi? Do you want to talk about anything you're doing?
Sure. I'm the guy responsible for taking anything that Dan needs code and implementing it and then giving it back to Dan. So if Dan needs something in code, he'll call on to me.
So we need to clone Mark too?
Yes.
Mark's been doing a really good job. So, and one of the fun things is Mark, you basically come from the sort of modding world and programming stuff, which is kind of cool. Because what was that? You were working on that, the source.
I'm currently still active as a developer for Black Mesa Source. And if you haven't heard of that, it's a gigantic mod project that's still going on today. And I'm still a part of that. And that's pretty much why I'm here.
Yep.
Yeah,
no, he showed us the work. And, from our standpoint.
Can all the people in the back just squat down a little bit?
I just think the headset cut off. We were like really impressed by, basically the ability to like mod and figure out stuff without like having manuals of people to tell you how the code actually works is something that's a sign of what it takes to really make good games and be a good game program. So, but we got some really cool stuff happening in all the ship systems. And then I think you probably know David Haddock, who's sitting kind of there to the front, not having his head cut off. I think it's just the format ratio, basically, on the Twitch feed versus what
people
we see.
People are now complaining about the mic.
Everybody's a complainer.
Now the lighting.
Dude, you're the one that did it.
Damn it, Alan.
One job. One
light. Yeah, exactly.
A lighting expert, right?
And so a little later on, Dave will be talking Squadron 42 a little later on. We were hoping to have the Foundry 42 folks, but it's late in the day for them, and they're actually doing some work up in Edinburgh with the group of contractors that's working on some of our AI, which we haven't necessarily announced, which we'll do later on, but we're doing some really cool core fundamental AI stuff that's upgrading a lot of what's already in CryEngine, so we're actually putting a different AI system into the game, which is going to have the next generation of personalities and AI for dogfighting and all the rest of the stuff, which is pretty cool. And in the very corner, which you can't see because he's running the computer mixing between the different feeds here in LA, is Travis, who is our producer here in Los Angeles. We don't have a camera pointing your way, do we?
Hello.
Just jump in front.
Yeah, you can jump in front. All right, he's going to jump in front so you can see him.
Or not. Oh, I can't get out of here.
You can't? Maybe later on you can. What schedule, what time are we at? Okay, so we got, all right, so I think we got a little bit of time. So let's take some general questions for the group here if people have stuff. I think we have Ben in Austin, who.
I am out here. Can you hear me?
We unmute Ben.
Yeah. There we go. Good. Hold on, getting a little bit of lag here.
Ben, can you hear us?
Guys, can you hear me?
Are you on mute?
Well, just a moment, I'll grab Michael Moran.
No, you can't hear him.
Oh, yeah,
yeah, that's some Skype.
They can hear you fine, dude. They can hear you fine.
Okay. All right. So let's take some Skype questions. Or not Skype questions. Questions from the chat roll. Chat roll, you have any questions for the LA team?
No, it's unmuted.
Chat roll is going a mile a minute, of course. They're all excited to see Eric. Let's see.
Up volume? Yeah, I'm trying to. Well, you should see it.
Well, folks are asking how the dogfighting module is going.
So, how's the dogfighting module going?
Yeah, but...
is there another input on the TV? The number one question there.
Yeah, we're getting that over and over again. Well, what are you guys
talking
right, okay, Ben, you're back. We can hear you, I think.
Oh, okay.
Excellent.
First question, how is the asteroid hangar coming?
How is the asteroid hangar coming? Well, I think that would be a question for Austin. I think we're going to have a discussion about the hangar stuff later on. We're in progress. I think it looks cool. We actually went back to the drawing board. We kind of went forward with it, and then we sort of decided we needed to have a small asteroid hangar for just Cutlass, and then a bigger one if you've got Caterpillars and some other stuff. So we sort of redesigned it to have a two-tiered asteroid hangar, which now back is in progress. I'm not quite sure what our schedule is, whether it's just before the end of the year or beginning of next year. That's the asteroid.
All right. Land Standard would like to know how Oculus Rift support is coming.
Well, actually, good question for Jason. We have a working version of of the Oculus Rift around. I think we actually even demoed it during our CitizenCon to some of the backers who stopped by the offices. There's still a few things. We're waiting for an updated HD headset that has better optics because that one was an HD set, but had the old optics in, and there's still a couple of little latency issues with the Cry engine. But generally, it works. It's in the game. We're not ready to release it to everyone on the public side, just because we want it to be perfect and have the latency as low as possible. So, but I would expect that
we would be doing something that would be public on the Oculus in the beginning of next year.
Apparently, sounds really bad on the LA side.
Not sure. Give me a minute. I'll work my magic.
Yeah. Okay, we're ready. All right. Ben?
Okay. We got a lot of folks wondering about the concept behind the brand new merchant men that we're selling today.
Yeah, it's pretty cool, eh? the concept of the Banu was that, you know, the idea with them is, you know, they've probably been starfaring for longer than humanity's been out in the stars, but they're maybe not quite as you know, I guess technologically inclined, they're more sort of a trader, bartering, so they kind of get what they need. So the idea is it's sort of like, it should feel like tech that's been around maybe longer than our tech, but necessarily isn't like constantly trying to like change and iterate. They've got like what they think is good enough. And so the concept of the Banu trader was sort of like almost an old, you know, a clipper, like an old clipper of, say, the turn of last century. So it's still in progress. It's very early, but we kind of like the way it's going. And obviously, Banu traders and merchantmen are sort of they are the I guess, I don't know, the traveling salesmen of our galaxy. Dave, do you want to say anything about?
Yeah. I mean, the you know, part of it I think also is just that they sort of collect and trade with a bunch of different people. Like, they're kind of friends of everybody. So yeah, they sort of trade and incorporate their all the tech from all the different civilizations kind of into their own. But yeah, the idea of like they find a technology and they kind of stick to it, I thought was kind of a cool setup for them. So.
All right, on Ben.
One follow up to that: how does the Banu ship land?
That's a good question. We were debating that ourselves. So we shared. That was some of the earliest work in progress concept for it. So we just liked it. So we thought we'd share it. Normally we wouldn't share it so early, but because, you know, today is the last day of LTI, and we promised we were going to sell some stuff, even though we're not selling as much as everyone was demanding. We wanted to share it, even though the landing part isn't resolved yet. So we're not sure whether that bottom keel kind of folds in, or whether it lands differently, or things extend. So what will happen is we will be updating the concept and the progress of that as we go, so everyone can know.
People have noticed the PS4 and Xbox controllers, and they're worried about that, so you might want to.
Yeah.
He got us. He rumbled us. We've sold out. We got Bill Gates behind us. Like everyone, we have a PS4 and Xbox One here, so everyone can check out the new consoles and the new games, because essentially we just need to look at everyone and say, okay, we're going to destroy that, and we're going to destroy that, and we're going to destroy that. Purely research reasons. It's not any particular reasons that we're going to be supporting the consoles.
Get Chad's review of Rise?
Get Chad's. Well, I mean the good news is that, you know, like Rise, like technically is pretty. I think it's the best of visually of the next gen, and the facial and everything. And the stuff that we're doing is the next step beyond that, right? So it's because we have the same engine, and we're actually taking it one more step. And there's more advancements and fidelities in the rig and the animation. So if you think Rise looks good for the facial and the character stuff, we're doing that, but one more step ahead. So that's good news for everyone on Star Citizen. All right, Ben?
Yeah, we do actually. That worked on Rise
here.
So.
Yeah, sure, you did too, didn't you, Paul? There you go. And well, you guys also did Crisis.
Yeah,
too,
yeah, exactly.
Too. Yeah, got some pros with the engine here.
All right, we have a lot of folks wondering about the instancing system, especially surrounding capital ships. Wondering if two capital ships will be able to battle it out or not.
Two capital ships will definitely. You'll be able to have capital ship battles. I mean, that's part of the goal, is to have sort of big ships as well as small ships in the battle. So we're going to. I mean, we're still the instancing side is still something that. We're sort of figuring out the mechanics, and actually that's something we're actually actively working on right now. Oh, look, I've got Peterson sneaking in the background behind you. I don't think anyone can see that on our feed. So Eric just ran in the back flying a Wingman's Hangar card. But we're controlling the feed here, so anyway. the instancing, the way that we're work. Oops, Daisy, down, phone off. The instancing system is going to reserve slots. So we're going to reserve slots for different groups of players. So you'll never be able to sort of show up and like completely take over an instance. So there'll be, you know, if you and your friends show up, there'll always be slots reserved for people that wouldn't be part of your group or people that'd be your enemies. And we're sort of doing the same for, we'll do the same for capital ships too. So basically if our instance could have 100 different ships in it, we're not going to let 100, you know, people that are all friends show up and take it over. So we'll reserve some slots for capital ships, and there is some benefit on the bigger ships in terms of instancing, because we may be able to do some detailed like if you're not in that ship, the sort of online updates don't need to be as big, because if you're outside the ship, you don't really care what's happening inside the ship, you just care what the actual outside of the ship is doing. But that's all part of the long-term testing. It won't be, you know, like we won't have the big ships in the first round of the dogfighting, but later on as the dogfighting evolves, because it's going to be like the hangar module and the other modules where we're going to constantly be sort of adding and iterating to it. So the beginning of the dogfight will be pretty limited in terms of the Hornet, maybe like one or two other single sort of seater ships. Then it will be the Constellation, so you can have multi-crewed stuff, and that's when you start to be able to have the bigger ships. And really we're kind of gated on the assets being built, because it's pretty complicated. So just doing the Hornet with the damage states, the LODs, all the rest of stuff takes time. The absolute goal is for one group to show up with their Corvette, another group to show up with their Corvette, duke it out, launch fighters, and have a good old, a good old sort of battle.
Now the chat room actually has a number of users who are very concerned that Chelsea doesn't have a chair. that seems to be an ongoing theme right now.
What's that?
Back.
There you go, guys. Let me just clarify, guys, in the chat role, hangar questions should be saved for later. We're going to have some of the folks work directly on the hangar to speak to you a little bit later. So right now we'd like questions on dogfighting and the other work they're doing out in L.A. Legante would like to know who is winning the battle for most epic PC between Chris and Sandi.
Well, I'm winning right now because Sandy's waiting on some cards. Well, you haven't, isn't running yet.
Well, that's true.
but
four R9290Xs is faster than you, put it that way.
Yeah, but you have to
except
actually.
Except I'm generating a lot more heat than you.
Well, you also have to have it actually set up, so.
Yeah, it will be. Don't worry about that. Travis is on it, aren't you, Travis?
Is it set up?
No,
I think so. Right, there you go. So now there's two Titans in SLI and a 4K monitor and 25K monitor. All right, what have I got here? Are we going to blow this up? Is it going to blow up in my face? What's going to happen?
That was a gift from one of our fans.
All right. Chocolate makes one feel. Hopefully you'll feel loved by the Star Citizen community. Wow.
Oh.
Look at all this chocolate.
Holy.
All right.
Is it heavy?
Where's the shining gold light coming out?
I don't know. Can everyone see this on the... All right, look at that. That's a lot of chocolate.
That's enough chocolate.
Wow. Okay. Well, we're all going to die of diabetes. Thank you very much. Who's this from, by the way? Aurelius Pantheria Tigris. Tigger, I guess, maybe. Well, thank you very much. That is much appreciated. In fact, I actually think I walked past him when I was coming down the parking lot because someone went past me and said, have a good live stream. And I'm like, and I wasn't even. I was like, that's a weird thing to say to someone. And I went like two floors down and I'm like, oh, wait a minute. That was probably someone that stopped by the office. And I was like, thanks. But I don't think he heard me. So sorry about that. If I walked past you, I was concentrating on stuff. But thank you. Thank you for the chocolate. We will all have a sugar coma a little later on. Mm-hmm. Here we go. All right, back to questions.
I have a number of people asking about the Xi'an ship artwork, wondering when we'll see something. A lot of people are wondering if it's something you've seen in the past or if it's going to be a new design that is yet to be revealed.
So no, the Zhang scout we haven't shown. We're working on it. I'm not 100%. We're not 100% there with something we're ready to show. It's going to be cool. You haven't seen it in any of the sort of Zhang concept stuff. You've seen kind of the idea of the Zhang ships, which is going to be more vertical rather than sort of horizontal, which is sort of the human design and also the Vandal and the Banu design. But the Zhang scout no one's seen, and we're sort of in the stage where we're trying to detail and model it out with you know more fidelity than sort of generally the conceptual sketches, which has been more about sort of Zhang environments. But that is definitely something that we'll be coming back and showing. So it's a high priority for us to show the Zhang and the Banu as it develops now that we are letting you guys put them in your hangars, and I think quite a few of you put them in your hangars, so that's kind of cool.
All right, let's see. A lot of people asking about the size of the Banu merchantmen. How big a ship are we looking at?
I don't know, Ben, as far as it goes, it's not quite as big as the Starfarer, but not too far away from it. I mean, it may actually be slightly longer than the Starfarer, but may not carry quite as much cargo. But it'll be close to it, right? I mean, so pretty much the of our big merchant ships, the Starfarer and the Banu merchantmen are the ones that can carry the biggest payloads. Well, if they got people got questions for people here.
Oh, that's true.
Let's see, people wondering about ship upgrades. Will they be able to replace missile mounts with more guns?
That is that's a good question. I mean, our system's pretty data-driven, so if we defined a mount that would be able to mount missiles and also mount guns, then you could do that. It sort of depends on the ships and how we want to balance them. Potentially, but if a ship specifically says it's a class 1 or a class 2, class 3 mount, and we stick to that, then it will only, like a class 3, if you're only a class 3 mount, you'll only mount sort of missiles, like basically things like, you know, chaff or missiles or that kind of ordnance. But it sort of depends. We certainly can define a hard point that could, like, mount a turret or mount missiles as well. It's completely data driven in the system.
Here's a question for our AI programmer. Will NPCs have different levels of effectiveness?
Yeah, AI has what we call profiles, which is a kind of behavior you set to them. So for example, you might have a timid AI that will be kind of hesitant about fighting very well, or you'll have an aggressive AI that'll go very, very hard against you. So yeah, even if it's the same kind of ship, they can behave drastically different from each other depending on the profile.
And we also have a number of people wondering how many NPCs a particular account will be able to hire. I think people are imagining hiring entire armies at this point.
We haven't decided how many NPCs that you can hire. I mean, obviously, it's going to be gated by performance issues, so we probably won't let you, at least crew your ships with too many NPCs. So I don't know whether we would let people, you know, hire 10 people or 4 people or 20 people. That's still to be decided by what the system can support. But we probably wouldn't want someone hiring a complete army. And I mean, we're not an RTS game, right? So I think we would sort of limit it to, I would guess, I mean, I'm just being arbitrary, but less than 10 or less. But it hasn't been decided yet. So, and don't forget, NPCs also will take up some performance. So you know, they will impact how many other players can be sort of in that area as well.
Sounds good. Let's see. A lot of people asking about the Starfarer Gemini, which is the military variant of the Starfarer, wondering if we will be offering that at some point. I think too soon to know, though.
Yeah, you gotta wait. I mean, yeah, we got a bit of time left in making the game, so you know, we can't. You gotta Got to save some things for next year.
Let's see. A lot of hangar questions, guys. Save your hangar questions for later. Wondering if you can talk a little bit about plans for cosmetic ship customization, skins, and that sort of thing.
Yeah. Well, so actually, that's currently something that we're doing a R&D on, and we have Brendan and Jason and Austin are the most familiar with it, but we're investigating some texturing techniques, not too dissimilar that was used in Brink, if any of you guys out there have known that, or was used in Rage, which allows us to sort of at runtime synthesize textures, so we can sort of bake down various decals and painting onto a texture, and we can support it without having too much performance hit, which isn't in CryEngine, so we actually have to build that specifically. But that's the kind of thing that we're doing. And it's also, by the way, just to let you guys know, this is exactly the kind of thing that the amazing support that you've done out there of all the money that you've given us allows us to do. So we're actually investing a bunch of money into sort of technological research and upgrades that maybe won't come online tomorrow or won't even come online in 6 months. But now we can actually go and say, you know what, we will spend $500,000 doing a texture synthesis technology that we'd plug into a CryEngine, because that's a pretty big task. Not many games have that, because for the long term of the game, if you know everyone wants to run around and have custom looking ships, and you know, hopefully Star Citizen goes for many, many years, that's something that we think would be really useful. And so we can actually do that now, which is kind of cool. One of the big things that getting so much support so early is allowing us right now to go much wider than I'd originally planned. So that has a few downsides in that we've got to ramp everyone up. So in the immediate, like some of the immediate stuff, maybe we're not quite delivering quite as much stuff to you right now, but you're going to see the benefit of it down the road, because we can go really wide. So we're essentially got groups working on every single facet of the game. And the previous development sort of setup was that wasn't necessarily going to be the case, and so we would get some stuff done and move on to the next one. So we're right now in active process on the first person boarding. We're in active process on the planet side stuff. We're in active process on the dogfighting stuff, on the hangar stuff, on the big MMO backend stuff, on Squadron 42, obviously, which obviously we made the announcement of Aaron and a whole bunch of people that are dear friends and I've worked with for a long time and have built some really great single player space sim experiences. So all that is all happening right now. So actually one of our biggest development challenges is setting the infrastructure up so we all talk to each other really well, how it works together. But I think it's going to pay off spades, especially next year as we roll into it. We're actually going to be able to deliver a greater amount of content, which will be great. So hopefully that answers some of the question.
All right. Adrian would like to know if NPCs are going to be able to learn, similar to the way they do in Forza, apparently.
Yeah, I mean, that's kind of one of the goals. I mean, there is a question about whether you, train your NPCs up the higher for you, but I think that the idea would be that you would have NPCs that the more they get experience, they'll do combat, perhaps they potentially will get better, but part of the idea is to have some of the AI code that essentially learns from what you're doing and maybe adapts to what you're doing.
Archangel would like to know how we load and unload cargo on our ships. Are we going to have to go in there and crate and uncrate each individual piece or what?
No, you're definitely not going to have to get a pickup truck or get a forklift and start loading up stuff, but essentially we're going to try to have some level of visual immersion to it. So if you buy some goods and you can come out maybe onto the landing pad and you can maybe see some stuff being loaded into your ship, but we haven't quite figured out the mechanics and how we're going to do that. But we want you to go into a trading place, see crates and say, oh, I want that and that and that crate, and then you come out and you can see some background NPCs like loading some crates into your ship, and then you can take off. We got the lamp.
Actually, that was someone saying, "Damn, I wanted to pilot a forklift." So.
Well, you got the buggy.
Yeah, you got the buggy.
Yeah, you guys caused enough damage with that buggy. Folks are wondering about emotes for characters for role playing. What level we're going to be seeing?
We're definitely going to have a good level of facial stuff. So we're planning even like on the dogfight that we would have different reactions for your face. Like, you know, you're intense. You're on someone's tail. Someone's on your tail. You're a bit worried. You just blew someone up. You're happy. So we're going to have a level of just sort of facial reactions. It's going to be really strong in Squadron 42. And so we'll probably let you in the sort of multiplayer side when you communicate with other people, be able to sort of key up those emotions from your chat window. And then we also have live driver, which we actually have some working stuff for, which is kind of cool. Basically, you have the webcam and you're sitting on your side and you can talk, and on the other side, the person playing the game can see your avatar move his mouth to your actions. So you can say things to your webcam and you can see your character on the, and someone playing against you will see your actual avatar animating and talking, which will be pretty cool.
Skylar would like to know how larger ships like the Idris and the Banu and the Starfire will fit into hangars.
So that is a good question, and that is one that we haven't figured out the answer to yet. So we've sort of been debating, like, how do we handle, like, the really big ships? Do we sort of have a landing pad outside that you can go and see them on? Do we make an even bigger hangar? But we haven't made the answer for that yet, so.
Now, a bunch of people are asking about how the face tracking would work with the Oculus Rift.
That's a good question. Probably not so well, since it certainly couldn't track your eyes. It probably could track your mouth. I'm not even sure we've tested it with the Oculus Rift, so that's probably something that we should try. But I would think that you'll lose the eye, because the one nice thing about the live driver stuff is that it tracks your blinking and your eye movements, it tracks your mouth movements, but obviously kind of with a certain amount of imprecision. It's not as accurate as a really high-end mocap system, but it's enough to sort of drive an avatar and match up mouth movements to speech and stuff like that.
Let's see, a lot of people asking about the track IR support. Are we going to be seeing that with dogfighting, or is that further down the road?
Well, we're definitely going to be supporting track IR. I don't know if we're going to have a track AR. Probably won't be supported for the very first version of dogfighting, but it will come online at some point next year.
All right. A lot of people are just asking how dogfighting is going. What are you all up to right now?
Well, everyone's
quite busy here working on dogfighting, and actually a lot of most of Austin's actually working on dogfighting too. So. I think it's going well. I mean, I think the issues that we have right now revolve around I think I've mentioned it in a couple of interviews, but there's some decisions to be made in terms of the multiplayer and the back end system of it. So we sort of are faced with this: do we do a kind of shorter term solution where we just use the existing sort of multiplayer stuff that you get with CryEngine and kind of hack that, or do we actually integrate it and use it properly with the distributed like universe cluster system that we've built, which also pays off with the hangar allowing different people to enter the hangar and would pay off on the planet side. My personal inclination right now is to do it the right way the first time, not like do a sort of placeholder and then actually do the full back end later on, because it'll push off how when we can get the back end, the big full one working. So that's kind of, we're sort of making that technical decision right now, because that will determine whether you get the dogfight now or you get it a little later. But we're making really good progress. I mean, the ship system stuff's really cool. Like a lot of the visual stuff, which we're not quite ready to show you because it isn't quite polished yet, is pretty awesome. So we've got some, like the damage stuff's gonna be pretty brilliant, because like the ship, it's not just like one little piece of debris or anything. Like, I mean, Dan, you want to talk about it? I mean,
we got multiple different damage states that we're working on, so we're going to have different pieces of like your wings flying off before you're actually destroying the wing completely. And then when the wing gets actually blown off, then all the damage states for that will disable the weapons that are attached to those particular parts. You also see like the landing gear coming off of it as well, so that won't be functional when you're actually trying to land, so you have to keep that in mind when you're looking at possibly landing. So we'll have to address that as an issue. Multiple different things with that. Mark is definitely giving me a hand on that, so we're expanding the damage states capability of the cryengine with that. And we also got like tons of lighting stuff that's also being worked on with Alan. So we're also going to be having like maybe different lights and warning klaxons going off as your damage stage is happening. Particle effects with different like sparks coming off of the wing when it's all blown off. Same thing with like your engines, and we got the pipe system that's also responding to this as well. So if you're in a damage state, this will affect your piping system. So there's tons of complexity with all the damage states that we're.
Well, I mean, and I think we've got, you know, like, I mean, on the light rig that you and Rowan, who now is back in England, but he's the second lighting artist that we have, who came to us from Crytek UK, I believe. Mm-hmm. Like, there was 68 lights on the rig for the Hornet.
72.
See? That's a lot of lights for everyone out there, just to let you know. That's like, I think most console games, even with deferred lighting, can maybe, like, handle...
50.
Yeah. So, I mean, the lighting for the Hornet, levels of detail but cinematic. The ship systems, I don't know if any of us done, like, Mark, what's the, like, on our count on, say, what do we got running in the Hornet? There's how many different systems? There's quite a few, right?
There's a lot. I mean, you got the power plant, the avionics computer, and then all the weapons, and then you have the radar. There's
You got your cooling units, batteries. You'd have life support.
Avionics.
And the avionics isn't just one package. It can be multiple, right? So it can be like your weapons, like weapon targeting computer, weapons control. Then we've got all the display stuff. So we've got the HUD stuff, which we'll show a video on later, which I think you guys are going to sort of can see where it's going and be excited by it. So we're basically building the level of like detail and fidelity for simulating you flying the ships is unprecedented, I think, over anything. I mean, more than any flight sim I've seen, and definitely more than anything I've done and anything I've seen on other space sims. And so it's pretty cool, but it's a lot of stuff. So and that just sort of means that like. The Hornet's a great example of like the amount of work. So yes, you can get inside your Hornet right now in the hangar and you go, okay, well, why can't you fly that around and shoot it? But like we have like huge amounts of damage states and details, and you have to have all the LODs, you've got to have all the different systems, you've got to have the geometry model for the systems. So there's a and then we haven't even mentioned the shield, which we're still working on. We're not ready to show you yet because we don't have the visuals yet that we're happy with. We have our own stuff that's happening internal, and that's a whole process. And and by the way, you can fire the shields will absorb energy from energy weapons, but maybe a projectile weapon can sort of penetrate them but lose some of their kinetic energy. So it's this all level of fidelity and detail that I don't think has been in there. And we also have a bunch more effects we're talking about. Should I announce there was a sale or something? I guess there's the second allotment of Idris's is available.
They're probably sold out by now.
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, so I wasn't focused on that. There's just like a huge amount of detail and fidelity, which we're having actually a lot of fun for. We think it's going to make the combat be a whole different level of experience. It's all going good. I mean, we're all having a lot of fun doing it. Downside of that. Including what we're talking about in the back end of the online system is that we're sort of debating at what point we want to give you all this and what point we think it's all polished and all the rest of the stuff. So we haven't made the full decision yet, but we may decide to push it beyond the end of this year. So don't shoot me just yet.
They're sold out.
They're sold out?
Yeah.
Also, our site crashed.
Yep, site crashed.
Holy. Well,
thanks, guys.
It's not a Star Citizen event without a site going down. Does it really crash?
It crashed temporarily.
Okay, well, it's back on now. Ben, next question.
Yeah, hopefully your response to Carol, since you take your time, get it right the first time.
Thank you. Yeah.
You know, there's a. I wouldn't lie to you if we didn't all like be kind of excited by X Rebirth and download it and then feel. Yeah. Taking time is a good thing. I mean, like if you think of, you know, all the people that you think are great, like Valve or Blizzard, and you play the games, or say the Grand Theft Auto games, you know, all those guys take the time to make sure the thing works and is polished. And I mean, the nice thing about having the level of support we have right now is that we don't have to worry. It's not like we have to, oh, you know, damn, we've, you know, there's a publisher saying, you've got to get it out tomorrow because I need it for my quota for my public stockholders. Or you get forced for a release of, oh, you got to be your launch title on the Xbox One. We need you out right now so we can't make the gameplay better. Which, by the way, I will guarantee you on pretty much most of those launch titles you've seen, which is why you're seeing mediocre reviews for it, is because they've been, okay, we got to have it for the launch day. So, and the cool thing with our process is you guys see it all along the way and you get to play it. So even if we don't give you the full dogfighting before Christmas, we're going to give you some stuff to play around with. So yeah. Dan's got something pretty cool that we think would be kind of fun that you guys will think. Can we show it maybe later?
I think so, yeah.
Okay, so maybe we'll show you later in the cast something that we're thinking of having fun with in the hangar, and you guys can use. But yeah, so we've got a bunch of stuff and we're going to share along the way, so it's not like we just go off and you don't see anything. But yeah, thank you for all your support out there.
Kaziansky would like to know if you have any consultants to work with on Squadron 42 to get dialogue, military stuff correct.
I know. Dave, you want to answer that one?
Not yet. I mean, I think the plan is probably to bring some, maybe have people come on to consult just to make sure that the military is. I think actually, Kaziansky asked me this when I asked a dev. But yeah, I mean, I feel like there's, I don't know, to me, there's always like there's a sweet spot of dramatically fun yet technically accurate that you have to hit that doesn't look too rigid. And, you know, so I feel like it'll be a process to figure out exactly where that sweet spot, so it feels like a legitimate military acting, and then, but you know, is not too cold and technical.
And we have, I mean, we have a vast amount of our backers that are,
yes,
that not just U.S. but like all around the world, UK, Australian, German,
yeah,
you name it, all around from every military around the world. So I think we got plenty of.
I got a PM. Couple months ago from a guy who, because I put in a thing, I was saying I was looking for books on submarine tactics, and so I got contacted by a guy who works on submarines.
Right, cool.
Also, questions like
the pilot who was on the 24-hour live stream sent us a very nice, very large booklet on
all the HUD stuff. Yeah, which is actually really useful, right? Mm-hmm. So yeah, we got a massive research from, I think, maybe it was Dane, I believe. Mm-hmm. So thank you, Dane, that was really cool.
Next one up, Ben.
Oh, it sounds like there are actually still some interests available. If people are trying to get some, they're still selling. Rush to get the interest if you want one right now. Let's see. Some folks are wondering about actors in Squadron 42. Have we talked to anybody yet?
Wait for the Squadron 42 section, which is coming up here. So we can answer it during the Squadron 42 section.
Yeah, we're going to talk about Squadron 42 a little bit later, guys, if you want to help some of those questions.
Chat
just went crazy because of the Idrises. I'm going to take a moment to catch up. One person is wondering about earning UEC during the dogfighting. Is that something we're talking about?
So, I mean, a part of our plan with the dogfighting is to allow you, we're going to allow you to fight and sort of earn, I guess, test credits would be the way to do it, and you can buy different things with the test credits, and we're going to also allow you to have so many test credits to try stuff out. And the the issue, you know, test credits will be, they'll go away when the proper game gets there, but it'll allow people to sort of play and try different stuff and you know, do that during the dogfight. So we haven't figured out the full mechanics, but the kind of idea is that, like, if you get into matches and you win, you would earn some sort of test UEC, and maybe you'd also just earn some test UEC by actually participating in the dogfighting, because really, I mean, the whole point of doing the dogfighting section is to, you know, do a whole bunch of stuff, which is, you know, balance the ships, see what works, what isn't working, figure out how the back end server load is, which is actually kind of like our biggest concern, which is one of the reasons why, like I was mentioning earlier, that I was thinking about taking a bit longer on it, because our biggest thing is how to make the experience for everyone around the world work really well. So, you know, we're now at a level, we announced that we're going to invest more money into infrastructure. So even in the dogfighting alpha, we're going to spin up servers around in Europe, in the US, and say Australasia or somewhere. And that was something that we weren't originally going to do. I mean, yes, we were going to do it for the final game, but in the early stages when we're testing, you know, that's obviously expense because you don't have the game live and all the rest of the stuff, but because we've had such great support, we can do that now. But of course, we've got to make sure that we have the system that deploys, that spins up the servers automatically. We're looking at Google Compute. I mean, if I had we have the Austin section later on, so if Jason is in that one, Ben, that'd be good. We could probably talk about some of these sort of back-end MMO style stuff. So our goal is to sort of try and make that experience really good rather than have it sort of not so good in the alpha, almost like we're using the alpha to test the load balancing and the stuff for all the multiplayer stuff. So yeah, that's, you know, thanks that we've got enough resources from you guys to be able to do that. But it's gonna make a better game. Am I getting the signal of five minutes or something? Okay.
What's happening in 5 minutes?
I'm wondering if you'd be able to
upgrade ships during the dogfighting module beyond just swapping weapons around. Will we see different ship systems upgradable?
Yeah, that's also
part of the goal. I mean, again, that's another one of the asset issues. So our goal with the dogfighting is we're going to deliver sort of the core base, and then we're going to constantly be adding extra things like, okay, here's some new avionics packages. Here's some new weapons packages. Okay, now you have two different batteries you could get instead of one, or here's an extra, you know, here's the overclocker cooler version that, like, keeps your heat down, because, you know, balancing, like, your sort of heat and energy in your ship is actually going to be a bit of a mini game, because everything generates heat, most stuff pull energy, and so, you know, I think not too long ago, I think we had our settings slightly off, and you fired the Gatling gun, and, like, it was done, right? Your energy was drained.
Yeah, all your battery power was gone.
So yeah, there'll be a lot of that. And so the point is, as we go through the test, we're going to sort of release more and more of these components, because in the actual final game, these are things that you would buy or as you would go around from planet to planet, and you basically, the idea is you get to customize or set up your ship for your particular playstyle. So that's part of the dogfighting test, is to see how all that works, balance it, and, you know, even, you know, we're going to do some of our playing here, but obviously when there's, you know, a couple hundred thousand of you out there playing it, that's, you know, I mean, that's the best play test and feedback and focus group you can ever get.
Cool. People ask about new t-shirts in the work. I guess that's a question for Sandi.
Yeah, I think
we have Sandi coming up here a little later on today, don't we?
They're hoodie samples. Look at that.
Has Drake on the front,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, it's Drake on the front. They just came in yesterday, so I still have to check the quality on them and everything. Wash them, wear them, do all of that stuff, try them on all the guys.
I used that one as a blanket last night.
Oh, thank you, Travis.
So definitely wash them.
But yes, new t-shirt designs, we'll get onto that. I mean, it's cold for most of the world right now, so.
All right, chat roll just went crazy again. I guess they're excited about hoodies. Wondering how player-to-player communications are going to work in flight.
Well, I think that would be another good one to have Jason here. I mean, we've got a fair amount. I should have had Jason on your side. I think we're going to be doing a combination, so we'll definitely have sort of a chat channel IM stuff that you'll be able to do, and it will tie into the organization stuff that we're rolling out. I believe that we're rolling out an early test at the very end of this year and for everybody at the beginning in the new year. And it will be tied, so you'll have all your different channels tied into that. We'll probably have some level of voice, I think. Maybe that will be just tied into your organization, so you don't have to necessarily, or you can mute other people, so you don't have to have people say all sorts of obnoxious stuff to you. There we are. Look, you have Jason here. Hey, we had a question, Jason.
Jason, about in-game chat. So I was saying that we were going to have your general IM chat channels be tied to the organizations.
We have voice over IP. Not quite sure how we're going to, maybe that's only tied to your friends. Maybe you can have it wide, but then you can turn it off if you don't want to listen to someone being obnoxious. What other kind of communication stuff are we talking about?
We're also talking about having basically using an XMPP-based backend, which is a chat technology used like Jabber, and even Google uses it for some of their Google Talk stuff. So you could have the chat work on the website and in-game, and even maybe on a separate client outside of the game using your game account, of course.
So you can even be in chat playing the game and someone else isn't on the game, but in the website, tied into your organization, you're seeing your chat playing back.
Uh-huh, yeah. Or maybe they're on their mobile phone and you're in the organization chat and you say, we're about to have a big battle. Well, if you could get on and help, come on now. And somebody might see it on their phone and say, okay, I'm on my way. I'll be there in 15 minutes.
We have our mission of destroying everyone's productivity at work.
Yeah.
Well, while we have Jason here, we've had a lot of questions about folks wondering how Oculus Rift, TrackIR, HUD-S, et cetera, support is going. Want to talk about some of the stuff you've been looking at?
We haven't had a chance to start the TrackIR support yet, but we do have some devices here already at both offices to try out and test. The Oculus Rift support, we have working. We've tested out in the hangar. We've unified the first-person cameras recently, so that now when you're like in a vehicle seat, you can look around with the Rift as you're still in the seat, and yet still pilot control the ship separately from your looking. There are still some issues with the aspect ratio and latency, specifically like when you turn your head, how fast that the input from the motion sensors read your head movement. It goes to the computer, the game engine, and then it's rendered and the frame gets to the display on the Rift. We still have some issues where probably in the engine, there's a latency there so that you can kind of see a delay if you turn your head real quickly, which I think will probably be important in like dogfights and space battles. So we got an Oculus latency tester that we need to, we haven't had a chance to use it yet to measure that and work on it.
Yeah, and by the way, that was actually one thing that Jason mentioned, the unified first person look, which we didn't mention in the dogfight, but that online is actually gonna be pretty cool because it's slightly different than the way CryEngine works, but it allows you to sort of have a unified look between outside and inside. And also, we sort of have a pretty cool system that we haven't shown off yet that hopefully I can show off in the near future that will allow sort of dynamic focus for your sort of view and avatar as you're moving around. And also, like the impact of like G-forces and impacts on your ship. So like as you're flying around and you get hit, I mean, if you ever see anyone's, like you see people do a point of view and an artist does a cool one and you get jolted around as you're flying around, you know, well, the system that we're building procedurally will handle that. So like if there's an explosion near your ship and there's an impulse on your ship, you'll go there and like you'll actually get jolted around and your character will have that reaction in the seat and you'll sort of see it in the movement, and hopefully it'll make the feeling in the cockpit much more immersive rather than the typical one, which tends to be pretty like fixed and you're rigid versus your, you know, in real life you would be like a separate body kind of attached to the ship you're in, but if there was forces, you would have some level of independent movement. So we're trying to simulate that. and the system's going to be pretty cool. So we haven't shown that off yet, but I think people will really dig that. Are we good? Does this mean it's 12?
There were requests to read the $32 million letter saying you didn't post it.
Well, I'm in here, right? Thank you, everybody. You guys are amazing.
Thank you.
I can't. We can't write letters fast enough. We like seriously consider. Well, maybe we should just stop raising money for a day so we can catch up. No, it's pretty awesome. I mean, like I said, I mean the money that we're raising basically is just ensuring that this is going to be the best damn space sim ever, because we already have more funds today than any other space sim has ever had in the history of space sims. And obviously, we're going to get new people coming in over the next year or so. So, you know, we're getting into the range where, you know, we were competing with big AAA projects just because we're super lean. We don't have any big corporate overhead or all the other things that a bigger company has. But now we're getting into the range where we're like kind of at the sort of budget range where we can really like, it doesn't matter. I mean, you know, we can compete with anyone. And because we've got you guys and this is an ongoing process and we're going to be rolling out over time, I just, you know, but yeah, sure, there's going to be a few times where, you know, something doesn't work, but this isn't like putting on a disc and that's it. It's like we're constantly fixing and patching it, and we just want to make the best game ever. Everyone here working here basically is doing this because they love this genre and they love what they're doing. And so we're gonna get there, and we have the support and the resources now to do it. So I'm pretty confident this is gonna be something epic. You know, maybe not every single second of the day, but by the time we get there and you sit back and say, okay, that's it. That's kind of like the base level of what Star Citizen is going to be. I'm hoping it's going to be something that everybody here, myself, and all you guys out there being part of it will be proud of being part of, because I think it's something completely unique and completely special in the industry. And I'm just always blown away by the enthusiasm and the support. And I guess couldn't have really done this sooner, but it's the most fun I've had ever making a game. It's really invigorating to have everyone's support out there for it. So anyway, that's my rambling letter for you. And I guess now we have the video, right? That I'm probably late on running. Yep. Rolling.
The thing that excites me most about Squadron 42 is the chance to create a cinematic and immersive playing experience that hasn't been seen before.
A brand new game, right from the start.
There's a lot of people out there, you know, chomping at the bit. You know, and it's going to be a huge game.
It's really a chance with the technology, going PC only, to really deliver something spectacular.
When Chris came to me originally, he said that, you know, the universe of video games and the technology and software had caught up with his desire to make character-driven games.
There's a subtlety of movies, there's an emotion that you try to get across in moments and characters that I think I didn't appreciate until I was really sort of immersing myself making films. And so I really want to try and bring a lot of that back into specifically Squadron 42.
Sort of my first task when I came on board was, you know, all the kind of basic framework for what would go on to become the sort of beginning of the lore.
The first big challenge has been nailing the big story outline.
To create a strong framework for the story for Squadron 42 that's going to drive the game along, and also working with all the various offices that are around the world.
We have to write character work and relationships for people over whom we have no control at all, which is a fascinating challenge.
It's tough because you need to have a story that can shift and change based on how the player plays it.
So I think that in previous incarnations of games, a lot of the branches had to do with whether you won or lost a battle. Now they have to do with how you treat a wingman, or what kind of moral decision you make in a particular situation.
The great thing about being able to sit in a room with the guys from Manchester and Chris and talk about the story is we get to lock it down. We get to kind of look at this and go, all right, here's what we're working with. Let's build off that.
Yeah. It's a good progress this week. I think we've pretty much nailed it now.
Now we know, you know, what the scope of the game is. We'll be pulling a lot of people, I think, to make it happen. I've known Chris and Aaron since we were little kids, sort of 4 or 5. We pretty much started school together, stealing Chris's early attempts to try and pass my exams.
I've known Chris and Aaron since the age of 4.
Worked on his first games.
Just a tight-knit group of friends, and it's just going to be so much fun.
Look, we're buddies again.
I knew Chris in a different life when he ran Ascendant Pictures, which was his film company, and I was his president of production.
First game I worked on was Striker's Run, which was one of Chris's back in 85.
Games such as Privateer 2, The Darkening.
Privateer 2.
Starlancer.
Then it was Starlancer. Then I had a fun 3 years on Mace Griffin Bounty Hunter.
I'm working for Warner Brothers on Lego, on the various Lego titles, Lego Star Wars.
And with Chris's company, we did Outlander, and we did Lucky Number 11, and we did Lord of War. And when this came together, he asked me to join the Squadron 42 team as a consultant to help lock a story down, because he wants a more cinematic, more character-driven story than is common in games.
It's not something you do very often, and starting a new company up as well to do the game.
I got the call from Nick, you know, saying it's a go. Then I spoke to Aaron and he said, you know, what do you think? I was like, I'm in.
It was a weekend that Aaron rang me, and I had the family round, so I had to kind of drop a Sunday dinner to take the call.
And it was only when they were leaving, driving back to the airport, they happened to mention the idea of us doing the game.
Time for a new challenge. Yeah, it doesn't come any bigger than this, does it?
An opportunity we just couldn't turn down.
I'm actually really excited to be working very closely with the community to basically make something for the people who can be playing the game, rather than just developing something and then putting something out there under the sort of constraints of working for a publisher. And in terms of the way we're doing it now, we get to basically, you know, work direct with people. You know, we spend a lot of time on the forums understanding what people want and what they feel, you know, and basically where they want to go. And obviously we have a very clear direction we want to take it, but also it's great to also get that feedback from other people as well.
Something that can be extra special given the sort of support from the community.
We are making a game for the people.
I think that this company has completely reinvented the model of how to make media, frankly. I think that it's important to see opportunity, that you know, the world is there to be reinvented.
We're working very hard to make sure that the story and the immersion and what we bring on Squadron 42 is going to really create a fantastic introduction to Star Citizen.
So I'm really kind of looking forward to advancing that level of sort of cinematic engagement that I did with Wing Commander with Squadron 42. And so, yeah, as far as I'm concerned, Squadron 42 is going to be what I would be making a next-gen Wing Commander of all by itself. So it should be, just by itself, as good as any $60 retail AAA console game. And then you're going to have all the Star Citizen system universe on top of it. So I won't be satisfied with anything short of that.
Because it's so important that this Squadron 42 will lead the players into the persistent universe, and we want to make sure that that first glimpse of the universe absolutely blows people away.
Chris is
are we going to that camera?
Travis, are you checking the chat roll?
Are we talking stage right or camera right?
Travis, are you checking the chat roll?
We're going to this camera.
Twitch chat roll. No, are you?
That's not camera, right? Is it?
Yeah, I'm watching to make sure we're
Yeah. Okay. Camera's pointing this way.
No, because that's stage.
Right.
Because the camera is always reversed, so that people can go, you go to the right or left of the camera, the camera pointing
forward
you.
Facing,
so that would be stage right.
Right.
Or whatever you want it to say.
Well,
just
I'm
to let you know,
Travis. I'm just kind of answering here and there.
They're all reminding you that you're live.
Okay.
We are live.
As we discussed the virtues of
giving
stage right versus camera right.
Stage right versus camera right, which is
very different.
Yes, exactly. If you've ever done film or TV,
Dave Haddock knows that. He's just having a brain fart.
No, it wasn't really so much Dave. But Travis. Okay, so that was the Squadron 42 video, which we did show on Friday. We were actually planning to debut it today, but you guys went and hit the 29 million thing on Friday, and we thought it would be appropriate because of the one of the milestones of Squadron 42. But now's an opportunity to ask Dave and I some Squadron.
See Chris.
You can't? Yeah. Oh, you cannot see me? What's my. Travis, can you see me or not? What's happening?
Well, I don't know. Somebody stage left got confused.
No, I mean, you're perfectly.
You're
I'm
in
the
shot.
I'm not in the shot?
You are now, but it looks very weird.
Why?
It looks like you're leaning into Dave.
Looks like I'm leaning into
Dave.
How about that?
The shot looks like.
Yeah. Let's maybe move this a little bit.
Yeah, frame it better then. Oh, now we're delayed. Hang on, let's see.
Hey, okay. Whoa. Is that better? Look at that.
Okay, so now is an opportunity for people to ask questions about Squadron 42, which we can't give you too many plot spoilers, but we're pretty excited by it, actually.
Oh my God,
so
I just realized Dave's t-shirt.
Yeah, Kid Crimson's.
Representing.
Yeah, it's a bootleg t-shirt there, Sandy. You may want to get have words with him about
right.
it.
Yeah, Dave, where's your license?
Right.
For that?
Yeah. So Ben, do you want to hit us?
Yeah, that's guys, let's have some Squadron 42 questions. The one we're hearing over and over right now is actors. Do we have any voice actors lined up?
Do we have any voice actors?
The process usually involves finishing the script and then going to the actors. So, you know, I've had some informal discussions with some people, but until we have a final script, which we're in the process of writing, we won't have any, and then I'm not sure when we'll announce, and we'll probably announce who the people are next year. But it's going to be, we have the resources to do some pretty cool stuff. And one of the fun things, because we're doing sort of performance capture and we can control what days we have people on, we can actually have some really great actors, and it's eminently affordable for us. So yeah, there's going to be some really good people, and there'll be some people that people will be happy with. But no, I can't announce anything right now.
We have people asking how long of a game is Squadron 42 going to be? Apparently, there's a rumor going around that it's just going to be the tutorial for StarCitizen. Set that rumor to rest right now.
Well, I mean, you know, in some ways, yeah. I mean, if you want to think a 15-hour experience is your tutorial for StarCitizen, sure. I mean, it's a great way to get into the universe. It's a great way to do dogfighting and learn the stuff and learn a lot of stuff in the systems. But it's not, you know, like a tutorial would be the wrong way to describe it. It's going to be, the campaign itself is going to be as big as any of the Wing Commander ones, even the biggest one, and it's probably going to be a little bigger. I mean, we're doing a lot of stuff that's very different. I mean, right now, like how many missions are we at, I think?
Oh, 50, or at least 50, or maybe more, 70.
Yeah, so there you go. Between 50 and 70, and a lot of the missions aren't simple, like, say, a Wing Commander mission. They're multi-stage, so you can take off, do something, land, do something, take off again, do something. So they are things that in a past Wing Commander would have been broken into multiple missions. It's a big story. I mean, this would be a $200 million big-ass Hollywood film.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think the tutorial sort of insinuates that it's just this is how you fly. This is a narrative experience, and it's a lot of cool personalities you get to interact with, some huge epic set pieces you get to be a part of, and so yeah, it's its own experience.
And in fact, we've sort of made a conscious decision that because this is a big thing that a lot of Foundry 42, my brother and Phil and Nick and those guys, that even though it teaches you, we're not like doing one of those typical, okay, go to the firing range, all right, fly around and shoot a drone.
Right.
So you basically learn in the story. You learn in the action.
But still organically. Yeah.
Totally organically, right? So, yeah, it leads you through how to use and fly the stuff, but not in a boring way.
Right.
So, like, as narrative is unfolding, which I think is going to be pretty cool.
Net would like to know if there are going to be first-person shooter missions in Squadron 42, or if it's all going to be space combat.
No, there's definitely going to be on-the-ground first-person stuff. They'll be boarding aspects. I think there's definitely going to be some on the ground stuff as well as the flight stuff. I mean, that's the beauty of what we're building, because we have the ability to go beyond the cockpit. We can sort of have a lot more variety. So it can really be like a big Hollywood action movie, other than, you know, with a lot of flying around and shooting stuff up in space.
Right.
Question specifically for Dave. Are we going to see Kid Crimson in Squadron 42?
I doubt it. I feel like it's
a very negative experience for Kid Crimson to be hanging around military people.
Behind enemy lines.
Yeah, it'll be a pretty short-lived cameo. No, I think we're kind of saving Kid Crimson for more of the Persistent Universes. Actually, I think there's a discussion going on in my Ask a Dev thread about, you know, Tanya Oriel and Kid Crimson specifically in the Persistent Universe, and will players kill them? So yeah, I think they're more relegated for the Persistent Universe rather than Squadron 42.
Yeah, and they'll be in the Persistent Universe, and we're thinking about doing some other stuff where maybe Kid Crimson and Tanya Oriel and a few other characters get their own sort of narrative and stories, but that's separate from Squadron 42.
And in reverse, they're wondering if we're going to see characters from Squadron 42 transition over to the Persistent Universe of Star Citizen.
Well, actually, some, but it's a pretty epic campaign, right? So not necessarily everyone's making it home.
That's true. We're discussing kind of ways forward to, you know, I guess the sort of bigger question there is like the crossover from the single player into the Persistent Universe, and we're discussing some options of ways for your experience in Squadron 42 to affect your life in the Persistent Universe.
So like if you have a wingman and you guys get, you know, strike up a relationship, and even if that wingman dies, but he says, you know, look up my family on this planet because I'll give you a deal on.
Right.
They
my
make
cousin
the best.
Owns a repair shop, ship repair shop, best in the universe, so I'll give you a discount.
And you take that and you would get a bonus if you develop that relationship in Squadron 42, that if you hadn't, you just wouldn't get necessarily the same bonus. Not that you wouldn't get the thing, but you wouldn't get necessarily the same bonus.
Folks wondering if they will be able to keep a ship at the end of Squadron 42.
Not particularly. I mean, the idea is the end of Squadron 42, you muster out, and then the ships that you have now, your starting ship is kind of what your ship is. I mean, you're in the military. I mean, you know, like if you retire from the Air Force, they don't say, okay, take your F-16 with you.
You drive a tank.
Yeah, take the tank home.
Go on, buddy.
Parking yourself. So, no, I mean, basically, it's your reputation. You're going to take the friendships that you would make. Some of that would pay off. But your starting base in Star Citizen is really sort of kind of like your starting ship, whether it's the Aurora
and your
citizenship. So if you play Squadron 42, you'll have a different social standing than maybe if you didn't complete it.
Right.
Sounds good. A lot of questions about what will carry over at the end. One user wonders if we will get paid more if we muster out with higher rank. Well, I guess I'll have a larger retirement benefit or what?
I think the way we've structured it is that you sort of have to go through the campaign. You can muster out early or you go through the campaign. So you're not, you know, there's a certain point in the story where you just can't basically...
You can't quit,
right? You can't go AWOL.
Yeah.
So pretty much if you get to the end, you'll end, everyone will be sort of comparatively at the same sort of level, more or less. So I'm not sure that would count as much in terms of sort of your ending bonus. I mean, we may have some level of bonus if you complete the story, then you may have some extra starting credits versus someone that just opts out of flight school and wants to just go to the Star Citizen universe.
Right.
But we haven't actually made a decision on that, but that would be one of the potential things.
All right. Let's see. What about Squadron 42 players that don't want citizenship? Will you be able to opt out of that if you're planning to become a pirate?
Sure. I mean, there's no issues, I think, on that level. I mean, I don't know whether we would have the the thing where you would have to show up to claim your citizenship, so if you just don't show up, you don't get it.
Right, or it's like a form you got to fill out as you muster out or something.
Yeah, so that won't be an issue to handle.
So don't worry about it.
And that's a great way to reject the UEE, become a citizen, and then become a pirate.
Yeah.
People are wondering about the dialogue system. Is it going to be like Mass Effect? How are we going to interact with characters?
So it's not going to be like Mass Effect in terms of a wheel selection. We're really trying to do something that's as immersive as possible. So, you know, I think I've talked about this before, but it's based on kind of like interaction, first person interaction, catching someone's eye, sort of like you would in real life. Like in real life, if you look at someone, you know, they look like they've just looked at me, and that's like, hey, you want to say something, right?
Right.
Talk, that's how you engage people. So we're going to have a system where your previous actions and also your demeanor and whether you're looking someone in the eye or not or paying attention to them will affect how they're responding to you. And then you sort of have the option where you basically, you know, maybe kind of a little similar to Wing 3 and Wing 4, where you sort of can hear your inner thoughts, like, you know, hey, Dave looks like a good guy. Maybe I'll shoot the shit with him, or I can't be arsed talking to Dave because he's boring. I wouldn't actually say those two things, but that's my inner thought. And then based on what I would choose, based on hearing sort of my thought in my head, I would have a response to him, and then my response would affect how he would, and
right.
would sort of go from there. So it'd be a combination of sort of, you know, mostly binary choices interspersed with sort of eye contact and body mannerisms that will affect your relationship with the person you're talking to.
Well, and one of the things you had said early on was, it, as a divergence from the Mass Effect system, was, you know, conversations are dynamic, and they start and they finish. They don't have the sort of thing in Mass Effect where you can kind of go back and re-click every option, and because that doesn't really feel like you're interacting, you're just sort of checking boxes. So we're actively trying to kind of stay away from that. So it feels like, you know, if you insult somebody, you don't get to go back. It doesn't reset and let you ask them a different question. They get annoyed and they walk away from you, type of thing. So they're more. It gives you more consequences to how you handle your conversations rather than just, I'm going to see every single possible iteration
right.
of what this person has.
No, I agree. I mean, that's my problem with Mass Effect is that, like,
yeah.
It took me out of the game because I would, like, literally do every question to make sure I didn't miss something.
Right.
And half the stuff really didn't mean anything to the game anyway. So, no, this is more, I would say, like, you're going down a river and, like, the rapids go left or right or left or right, and you've got to make that choice and you can't go
right.
back up it. But, you know, there'll always be opportunities later on to maybe, like, you know, get a relationship back to a better place
right.
than it
endure
was before,
them,
but
right.
it should be like real life. I mean, you know, if you just call someone a dick to their face, you know, you got to do a bit of work to come back from that.
Right, right.
User wondering if we'll be introduced to all the systems in Squadron 42, salvage, repair, combat, the stuff we're going to see in the universe.
Yeah, I mean, that's part of our goal, right? Our goal
sort of take you through Squadron 42 and learn how to use your ship systems, do it, learn how to, like, patch yourself up in after a battle. And I mean, that's why maybe people think, oh, it's a tutorial. It's not really a tutorial, but you will go through most of the game systems in the story setting, which will hopefully prepare you for the persistent universe.
All right. User wondering how the orchestral session is going, and we're actually going to have some more on that a little bit later.
Yeah, that's a good lead-in. Well, I mean, not just yet, but
in 5 minutes, we're going to play a new video, so you'll be happy with that. And then I think we're going to have Martin around to answer some questions. I don't know whether we'll have Pedro too, because he's in Portugal. Is it, we having Pedro too? Great, brilliant. So we're going to have both Martin and Pedro, who is our composer, to answer questions very shortly in about 5 minutes. So, 5 more minutes of Squadron 42 questions. Make Dave feel loved.
For the co-op campaign are going, what will we be able to do there, basically?
The concept of the co-op campaign is that you basically can drop in and take over some of the wingmen when you're in the battles. So essentially, flying the missions, instead of it being Wingman X, it can be Dave. Me and Dave flying the mission together.
I was kind of equated to the scenes in The Matrix where the Agent Smith teleports into the person's body, sort of like that type of thing. Like the NPCs are established, but it's just your friend is playing as them.
And not necessarily on the conversation side, right, on the ship. It's more in the action part. They can take over controlling them for the action.
Right, right.
And then during the other thing, I don't think we've decided quite what we do. Maybe you would just passively hang out and watch. Well, like maybe a third person view of what's happening.
Yeah, yeah.
While your friend plays a character so you can see him talking or whatever.
Oh, that'd be cool.
But yeah, that's kind of the plan.
Wondering if there will be different difficulties in Squadron 42, easy, medium, hard, or if it's just going to be the Squadron 42 experience.
That's actually a good question. I don't know if we've made a decision on that yet. Default, you would probably think, yeah, that'd be easy, medium, and hard. Can't remember if I even had that in Wing Commander. It's been so long ago. Maybe I did. I can't remember. That's actually fairly simple for us to adjust because it's the AI is going to. Ultimately, if we had the AI made it the hard AI, then it would be hard for most people to beat it. So we may very well do that. I haven't made the choice yet, although there is something to be said for not making anything too easy. So you actually have to achieve your victory. So we'll probably maybe have some modes, but nothing will be
static.
Too easy.
Vortex would like to know about penalties for not doing Squadron 42 versus benefit when you're starting out in the universe. Is it going to be something everybody wants to do, or is it entirely optional?
Entirely optional, but I think you would have to earn your citizenship a different way if you wanted citizenship. I think you would, you would obviously miss out on learning some of the way to use things or ship systems, but you can probably figure that out yourself anyway. I think that you'll miss some potential connections later on. So you should make some connections in Squadron 42 that could help you in the persistent universe. Now go look up this person; they'll give you some jobs, or go over here; they'll tweak your laser guns to plus, to be more effective. But they only do it for ex-vets or whatever it would be. You won't be handicapped by not playing Squadron 42. It should be a completely elective. It's just you will have different routes in the persistent universe to achieve the same ultimate status that you would have done by playing Squadron 42. But Squadron 42 is going to be fun. The way I view it is it absolutely could be a standalone, full-price AAA game, just Squadron 42, and then you've got the persistent universe added onto it.
Wondering about character customization in Squadron 42. Are you going to create your character at the start of the campaign, or is everybody going to be the same, square jawed?
You get to create your character. We've actually got a really cool way to do it that's completely in fiction. It will work, and it'll also pay off later in the persistent universe if you want to change. So I don't necessarily want to reveal too much of it, but I'm quite happy with it. I feel like it's completely in fiction. You can go completely buy it, and it will be cool. So you can be
a man or a woman. You can choose how you want. Have a lot of folks wondering when we're going to see our female character.
We are actively working on that. So we have a 3D female character, although we're now shifting our technology to full body scanning. So we're doing facial and full body. We hit a stretch goal. I guess it was quite a while ago. It's amazing just how quickly stuff has gone. We're doing facial scanning, but we're also going to be doing full body scanning. And so we're shifting to that now to sort of up the level of fidelity on the characters and the faces. So like the face that you've seen so far in our stuff is that's not like, you know, that's a 3 compared to what we're going to be doing. We may not show the current model female because we're going to actually do a proper body scan for a female, which is up and coming, actually. I think we're going to scan by the end of this year. So that should be all pretty good. But yeah, we're definitely focused on having our female and as well as the base male for people in the game?
Let's see. One user wants to make sure that we know he'd like to keep his sidearm after Squadron 42. Let's see. Friendly fire. Will there be friendly fire in Squadron 42?
That's a good question. I'm kind of inclined to say yes, because friendly fire is always fun. I think Maniac always used to generate a lot of friendly fire back in the original Wing Commander. So, I would say probably yes.
So I think you're wingman carefully if you're doing the co-op mode. Let's see. Is there going to be a medal on ranking system?
So what was that, Ben? A medal ranking system, you said?
Medal ranks. Like the original Wing Commander.
We're definitely, I think, going to give you medals and awards. I mean, you know, I would say sort of the Wing Commander as a model is the best. We're trying to like build it in such a way that, like, for instance, you know, like some of the later Wing Commanders, because we filmed all the stuff, we, you know, would keep Wingmen around for story points. But this one, we're trying to make more flexible. So, you know, you could finish the story and without, you know, the original Wing Commander, you could finish with all the Wingmen being dead, or you could finish with all the Wingmen still living. And we're sort of more in that direction than we are in the Wing 3 or the Wing 4 direction.
Sounds good. I'm personally looking forward to that. Number of flyable ships in Squadron 42, has there been a decision yet, can we say, or to come?
I don't think we've figured how many. What have you got so far on the outline?
One, two, at least six in some capacity or another.
There are at least six in some capacity or another, potentially more.
Yeah.
So fighters, bombers, probably transport.
Ops, like special ops.
Special ops one, so. Cap ship.
I'd like to know if all the dialogue in the game will be voiced.
In Squadron 42, everything's going to be voice.
And most of it, most of the
performance hero capture too. So.
So think, if you've seen Rise.
Think that level or better.
Question for I guess both Dave and Chris. Fiction influences for you in planning the story for Squadron 42. What inspires you?
I actually watched a lot of World War II movies.
World War II. I mean, we were also going. I mean, say Gladiator.
Right, that's come up a lot.
Is a big inspiration, because you know we're taking the lead from sort of the Roman Empire. Even though we're way in the future. So the Ninth Legion.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a little element of Gladiator, the Ninth Legion, World War II stuff.
Yeah. I don't know. I actually reread
Apocalypse Now.
Apocalypse Now.
Apocalypse Now. So.
I reread Generation Kill last week as part of the preparation for it, just because of like the personal dynamics between the guys. Firefly, of course. Cowboy Bebop.
Mm-hmm.
Always good ones
cool.
to go back to.
Yeah. Although, I'd say Firefly and Cowboy Bebop are more of the persistent universe.
Probably, yeah. But they're just always fun.
But we're trying, I think we're trying for something pretty epic in the story. So,
yeah.
I think people are going to like it. That's my opinion. So, we start really big.
Yeah.
And then we kind of go from there. So.
Yeah.
Flies with Scissors would like to know if there's going to be humor in Squadron 42.
I mean, I think even, you know, like even serious films, the best ones work well with, you know, Aliens is a greater example, right? That's a pretty intense movie, but it has great moments of humor, mostly involving Bill Paxton.
I think Hudson is one of the best characters in that movie because he's really funny.
Yeah. Game over, man. Game over.
One user concerned that all the voices might be British. Could you clarify that one?
No, I'll leave the
guys will be British. No, just no. It's we're gonna basically get cast like you would a big movie. So potentially there could be some British actors. There'll also be American actors. It should actually feel, you know, like that. The one of the things with the Wing Commanders was that, you know, I deliberately tried to make it multicultural, because it was the future. So you figured that, you know, all the different nations and races that we have now would basically all be fighting together for the Confederation. And that's no different, I think, than the UAE, is that it's definitely going to be multicultural. And in fact, I would guess that the future will be much more of a melting pot than it is even today, because, you know, as time goes on, you know, who's going to care what country you were from on Earth? I mean, you have all these different planets, and so
planetary identification more than.
Yeah, so I think you'll be kind of like, yeah, I mean, you know, you'll be sort of, yeah, everybody would be essentially some level of mixed, right? It's like now in America, you probably go back to people's genealogy and they're a little bit of Irish, a little bit of American Indian, they're a little bit of this, a little bit of that, if you actually went all the way into it. And I think in the future, you're going to have more of that, because that's just the nature of the expansion and the beast. So we're going to do that. So it won't all be English accents. It is orchestral time. Okay, we have a new video for you, and I think on the other side we're going to have Martin and Pedro for you guys to talk to. So let's roll it. Nice talking to you guys. I'll be talking to you pretty soon on the other side.
My name is Martin Galloway, I'm the audio director on Star Citizen. Now, we just finished the first of our orchestral recording sessions, and of course that's to satisfy the stretch goal that we reached back in November of 2012. And it was actually quite a surprise for us back in those days, because we just set that as some far off achievement goal, you know, orchestral session, you know, we'll never have that, but maybe off in the future. What actually happened was, on the last day of the fundraising month, that's when we hit the goal of $6 million. Pedro Camacho has been a part of the Star Citizen team a lot longer than anybody realizes. Pedro was inspired by this demo on October the 10th, from the videos to Chris flying around and his talk, you know, about what Star Citizen was going to turn out to be.
Just to hear Chris Roberts' name for me was enough. Whatever he was doing, he was back on games, it had to be huge and excellent. I was a huge Wing Commander fan.
Pedro Camacho was a Portuguese composer who divides his time between games, television, theater, and real performance music, like his famous Requiem to Inés de Castro. Pedro has already composed for over a dozen games, but I think Star Citizen is his biggest project so far. And Pedro immediately started composing and came up with more or less a 2 or 3 minute demo of what would become the Star Citizen theme. And he sent that to Chris, and Chris really liked it. And Pedro also helped us on the 3 commercials that we put out so far, the Hornet, the Aurora, and the 300i, which, you know, the music all sounds incredibly different in each one, but it's all done by Pedro. And Pedro is basically the composer on Star Citizen now. It seems weird to be recording the orchestra so far ahead of the final release of the game. Most game projects, they wait until the last minute so that they know exactly what the tune list is and how long every tune is supposed to be and all that kind of stuff. And in our case, we're releasing Star Citizen in a series of vertical slices. So we're recording the subset of tunes for Space Battle in this first session. The process of creating the music starts with the initial asset list of what tunes we're going to need. And for Space Combat, Chris and I basically went back to the old Wing Commander template and said, you know, we're going to need a tune for this part, a tune for this part. The music's going to vary according to how much damage you've got and things like that. And so it's fully interactive. And once it's broken down into individual clips of, you know, a minimum length, let's say, then we can approach someone like Pedro and say, you know, how long is it going to take to compose all this?
So once I receive direction from Chris and Martin, I'll make a sketch in MIDI and they respond if it's too fast or too slow. Then we go from there and then try to implement that track in the game.
So my MIDI workstation has all the notes from each instrument in the orchestra individually sampled. So when I combine them together, they actually resemble very closely what a real orchestra will sound like.
There's the creation of the initial music, if it's a theme or a texture. Then you have the orchestration, which is the adaptation for the large group of players.
Composing is like making a black and white drawing, and orchestrating is like coloring that drawing. That's why I always orchestrate what I do, because I want to be sure that in the orchestra session, I hear the colors I had in my mind.
So for Star Citizen, all the music you hear, every note, comes from Pedro. When the time came to find an orchestra to actually play all these parts, we asked Pedro, what do you think? And he said, well, I really have a good feeling about this group in the Czech Republic called the Kapellan Orchestra, headed up by Petr Pololjanik. They are a freelance group of players, mostly concertmasters and the principal soloists, you know, from different orchestras that get together to play these great scores for film trailers and video games. And these musicians have never seen this music before. They're not sent anything ahead of time. It's the first time I've ever seen it. And they're such good readers of music that they can do a good take almost from the first few minutes. The orchestral session is about 4 hours long, and it can be any time of the day, whatever we have booked. In the case of our recent session, it was in the evening from 8 p.m. to midnight. And the orchestra players all came in, you know, by themselves from different places, assembled and sat down, opened their cases. And they would start to play immediately. And they see the first page of the score, they get going, they play the very first take, all 75 musicians going at once. It's quite possible that there'll be a perfect take right from the get-go. They need to warm up a little bit, but you always record from the get-go in case there's a great take. The very first piece of music that Pedro submitted was the Star Citizen theme. And when we have a theme, we basically encapsulate an entity and all of its good sides and bad sides and details into one piece of music. And so we can say, when we're playing this piece of music, you think of this entity. Whether it's a person, a landscape, a planet, a nebula, you know, dangerous environment, or, you know, just the entire franchise.
There are several key themes that will be used throughout all the composition of Star Citizen soundtrack. These themes will be readapted to give a more adventurous or a more sad feeling to a certain moment of the game. For example, Star Citizen's main theme will be reused many times during Squadron 42 storyline in the most important key moments of your adventure.
Our game is no different from a regular film recording session in that it's a bunch of takes. When you play a music CD of the score of a film or a game, and each track sounds like it's complete, it's actually several takes spliced together with a lot of editing skill. And we have engineers that listen to the orchestra as it's playing and make little paper check notes and that kind of stuff as the performance is going through. And if they ever hear a dull note or something that could be improved on, they make a note. The rule of thumb is that you get between 5 and 7 minutes of final music end to end from each 4 hour block, which doesn't sound like a lot, but it's 5 to 7 minutes of perfect music. And so you need more than one session to get an entire game done. And even our dogfighting module has about 15 minutes of music. And I'm looking forward to that. This is always one of the most fun parts of the job for me. It's not just artists and designers. You get a violin player working in the game. It's a great thing.
All right. You're on yet or no?
Not yet.
I on it?
Yep.
Okay, so hey guys, a couple of things. One, we'll have
$32 million letter later on as soon as I can get out of the conference room and Ben can get out of the conference room, so probably after the live stream's over. We have Martin Galway online Skype here. You just saw the orchestral up. Yes, show. Yes, accept, please. There we go. And Pedro, hey Pedro, how are you doing?
Hey,
Howdy, Pedro.
You heard and saw some of Pedro's awesome work. And we thought it would be kind of fun for the community to ask Pedro and ask Martin questions about music and sound in Star Citizen. So over to you. I'll just listen here.
How are we getting the questions? Are we getting them from Ben?
Ben, yes. That's it.
Yep, I can... question for you guys. If you want to ask some questions about the music on the chat world, we will ask Martin and Pedro. Wondering if it will have AMD True Audio support.
I'll take that one. That's a yes. Chris commences to that at the AMD event, so yes.
All right. What's your inspiration for the music you've done so far? Squadron 42 and
StarCitizen. Yeah. Well, it's Chris and Chris Roberts because of all his lifetime work, and of course the game itself, which is absolutely amazing. I want to play it. I can't wait to play it. Can't wait.
Wondering if Pedro does music besides classical pieces.
Yes, I do. I do music for TV work, for other video games, and some film as well. So yeah, I do. Even though games are probably my games and concert are my biggest passions, perhaps. Yeah.
Hey, so also one thing, Pedro. I think on the previous question, I'm guessing that they're probably wondering why
film music or music in general, like, was inspirational for you outside of like the game itself, in terms of thinking of the music you were composing for Star Citizen. So,
you want to maybe speak to that?
Okay, other inspirations besides, there was a movie I really enjoyed a long time ago, which was The Last Starfighter. That was a movie that really touched me because it was a kid that wanted to be in the stars, and through a video game in the movie, he was selected to be the last starfighter. And so that movie really touched me. I really, really loved it. And Star Citizen is kind of like that. It reminds me of that movie. Of course, there are other movies that really inspired me, like Super 8. Like Star Trek, of course. That's I think that's everyone always have that inspiration as well. So maybe those are my biggest inspirations. So like classy old sci-fi movies, perhaps. And I think those were my biggest inspirations. Yes.
Yeah, chat folks went crazy when you mentioned The Last Starfighter. Apparently the our fans are also very into that movie.
Oh, yeah, I saw it like at least 7 times. So, yeah, it was great. Right. You've been selected by the, I forgot it, Korhan Armada, something like that. It's great.
Wondering if there will be dynamic music in the game. Will it react to what you're doing in the cockpit?
Yes. We are borrowing, like I said in the video, borrowing from techniques that we used in Wing Commander and Freelancer and things like that to bring adaptive music that changes in intensity, reflects the fact that you've got damage, or if you, emotionally things are going well, we will use, you know, more hopeful or positive music, and if things are grim, even if your ship's in great shape, but the battle is nearly lost, you know, we'll have music that reflects that.
There should be a small number of people vocal, however, who are wondering why we have sound in space at all. Can we address that part?
Let me add him. Okay, look. This is the answer. Look, all right, look. It's a game, and even though there is no sound in space. You know, the sound in some parts of space, if you're in a fine dust cloud, you will get some sound propagated that way, but most of the time there's no sound. We're going to have sound because that's a great way to convey the action, because you can only see out the front of your ship. Even with Oculus vision, you can only see in one direction. See, that's my animation right there. Sound's going to convey to you what's going on behind you. I mean, I'm not sure what these players want. The ones want no sound in space. They're only going to see in one direction. They're not going to really be able to play very well.
Well, the other thing there's a certain amount, obviously, like in Star Citizen and Squadron 42, I mean, there's dramatic license, right? So, you know, really the future of space combat and what would happen would be, you know, it would all be drones. You wouldn't have humans be doing it because we can't tolerate the forces you would have in the bodies. And it's a whole bunch of other reasons. So we're sort of going for a sort of, it's almost a science fantasy, right? So Star Wars could be deemed as a science fantasy. Battlestar Galactica could be deemed as a science fantasy. So it's sort of taking some things that we know from, you know, history, our past, and sort of putting it into the future. And so, yeah, you kind of think that you want to have sounds. And, you know, but even I would say, you know, Gravity, which is a pretty accurate film in terms of space, I mean, you know, there is sound in that. I mean, you know, when you're in your suit, there's definitely sound because there's oxygen around. It propagates. When you're in a space station, there's sound. So they actually did a pretty nice job of that. And there has definitely been talk that potentially you would, you know, maybe in the future, just like, you know, like if you have a digital SLR now, well, they don't have an actual shutter, but guess what? When you press the button, it makes a shutter sound, because that's what people are used to, and it's actual audio feedback for why they're taking a picture. And the same, you know, people are like, electric cars are now like having a muffler sound on some of them, so you can actually hear them, because otherwise you couldn't hear them. So who's to say in the future that you wouldn't necessarily simulate a level of sound for a pilot in a cockpit so he could have spatial awareness, which is to sort of what Martin's talking about. So that's definitely there, although, you know, who knows, for the purists, for the fun of it, we may have a, you know, turn the sound off check mark that could, you know, sound when you're actually out in the exterior, could be silent or whatever. We haven't, we may provide that as an option just for the people that really want to be pure about it, but you know, as I've said, there would be, you could definitely see some ways in a future where people would, you know, even essentially fake the sound for spatial awareness reasons. But back to Ben.
All right. Anti-X would like to know, Pedro, how do you get started writing a piece of music? Do you just pick a note and go from there, or what's your process?
I really have no clue. I'm being as honest as possible. I really have absolutely no clue. I'm actually a very visual composer, but when I see an image that inspires me, I just get fired with ideas. Like, I have to eliminate them and just pick one I want the best at the time. Without seeing anything, it's kind of... So basically, Star Citizen looks so good. So when I see any image, I just get like a bunch of ideas, like very fast. That's at least. Of course, then there is the time to produce it and orchestrate. That's a technique part. It's not all inspiration. There is a lot of technique, a lot of study you need to have to, you know, make it actually sound like a music. But I think he's mentioning like the start, like the ignition of a new piece, and that part is just like I have to eliminate by basically the ideas. That's it. Hope it answered.
All right, I've got a question here from Michael Nightingale, who has not missed the live stream yet. He's helping us out. Wrangling folks in Austin. This is for Martin. Are there going to be musical pieces that have non-standard timings, like 3-3 or 5-4?
We'll work that one out with Pedro over the course. We may try that for some of the alien races. It doesn't jump out as something we've got. Certainly not something we've got in the plan right now. But it's something that we could try because it's very alien. It's unexpected. It gives that unsettling feel that, you know, we as humans, you know, we're the human players of Star Citizen. There are no Xi'an players of Star Citizen who would think that the Xi'an stuff is all, you know, totally normal. we see those guys as aliens, and so we might want to use some unnatural sounding music tempos, right? Pedro, what do you think?
Yeah, I basically agree with you, yes. I agree with your opinion on that. Nothing further to add.
Pedro and I are on the same page when it comes to that.
Have a lot of people asking about other types of music, rock, jazz. Are we going to see anything like that in Star Citizen?
In fact, if I might extend to the question, a lot of people have asked me about what music's going on in the bars and on the planets, you know, in these places you walk in. It's not score, it's not like a storyline, it's like what kind of ambient music plays in these places. Over to you, Pedro.
Yeah, well, I really do have tons of ideas in that side, which I think we will all discuss as a team. But I believe I'm not. This is my. I like those games that when you go to a bar, all the music you hear is just, you know, like a futuristic techno. That's okay. But I believe that in the future you will also want to hear some jazz, some classic tunes, some 80s, actual current 80s tunes. I don't know.
1980s, so, that is, not 2080s, right?
Yes, 1980s. So like old school bars. And of course, I think there should be like modern modern of the actual the time in Star Citizen, like modern music of the period we are living. And there, I think there should, I believe that there will be a bit of everything. But of course, this is something that we are still discussing as a team, and to see what's the best option on that aspect.
Right.
Wondering how many scores the game will have.
I'm just making the same
face Martin.
I'm going to make a rough guess. Hey, Chris, do we have we said how many planets are in the game? Is it 700, something like that?
Currently, we have about 55 star systems and about 400 different environments that you can land on. And it may be more. I mean, you know, now that we've gotten more, we're not really finite. We're going to constantly be adding stuff. So we're still getting the environment, the pipeline up for building the environments and everything. But that quite potentially could be bigger because we're looking at some hybrid sort of built and procedural stuff. So allow us to sort of flesh out a larger degree of areas. But you will certainly be in that range. I don't think you need 450 themes. But you know, you're certainly going to have different kinds of places, big cities, small cities, outposts, you know, mining colonies, Xi'an, Banu, human, Vandal. So
yeah, I mean, we'll start off by categorizing them
into large groups.
The whole Star Citizen is just going to be an ongoing content job. I mean, you know, I tell people that start on it is like, no, you're not. This isn't like you're on a game and it's for just, you know, 2 years and you're shipping this thing. It's like, basically, if you want to make Star Citizen your career, you can do. You could be, you know, happily composing in 10 years' time new music for Star Citizen. It's not particularly finite. It's an ongoing process, which is both kind of exciting and scary at the same time.
Right. So to answer the original question, you know, we're going to start off by categorizing the entire Star Citizen universe into big areas like all desert planets and all, you know, certain alien planets and that kind of thing. And each one will get their own theme or entry music and landing music and the other kinds of events that we're going to use. And then as we want to dress up, it's like set dressing with music. We're going to dress up the set with specific pieces of music on specific planets. You know, if they have a specific piece of content on there, like a pirate boss lives on that planet. And whenever you go there, you see that pirate boss. So we may use a particular piece of music on that planet. Then you've got the interactive parts of the music for battles and the Squadron 42 scores, which are also divided into two bits. So the interactive things and all the passive moments, like when you're watching scenes in the story, I assume there's going to be, you know, storyline scenes that you go through that will have music in the background. So we're going to score all of that. We may start with generic pieces of score, kind of like if you ever watch soap operas, they start off with a library of about 20 pieces of music and they just pick one to play in the background. We may start with that kind of technique for our Squadron 42 stories, but then add specific pieces of music for the specific scenes as we go on. Hope I didn't say specific too many times in that answer.
You can give us more specifics.
Can you be more specific?
People are asking about a radio system like GTA. Is this something we can see in Star Citizen?
I get that question a lot, and I constantly bounce it over to the design people, because really it's a design question. Honestly, since Chris is in the room, he might want to wax lyrical on that. What do you think, Chris?
Well, we're definitely looking and considering like a jukebox system whereby, like, for instance, you're in your hangar or maybe even your ship, it can play music you have on your computer, you know, like in your iTunes library or whatever, just as a feature. In terms of radio and broadcasts, we're definitely planning on having like sort of news broadcasts and probably radio broadcasts that would be sort of in fiction though, right? So I'm not sure we're going to go to the GTA 5 thing where they've actually licensed a bunch of contemporary music and it's playing over the radios. Super cool, but it sort of feels like it would be a bit anachronistic for what we're doing in Star Citizen. But definitely, you know, like, you know, we have things like one-shot shipping news and all that sort of stuff. So the long-term plan for Star Citizen is to take a lot of the stuff, say, that Dave Haddock has been writing and you see sort of in written posts, and move them to audio or even full video production, where it's all about immersing you in the world. It's all about, so like, you know, my long-term goal would be, you know, you would be flying around or you'd be walking into a bar and like maybe you'd be hearing a podcast or you'd be watching a news item, and that show would literally be discussing events that were happening in the universe, right? So you would have, you know, we would be recording, our content team here would be like looking at what was happening in the universe, and the one-shot shipping news, whoever the actor playing that, would write a script for him that would be based on something that we saw happening in the universe the day before or 2 days before, and he'd be like, okay, it looks like, you know, in, you know, the Vega sector there's increased pirate activity and, you know, that kind of stuff. It'd just be kind of cool. So we'll definitely have a level of that, and probably allow you to sort of play your own playlist or whatever, but probably won't have necessarily like you know, popular bands playing music from today over our radio, because like I said, it doesn't really fit the sci-fi setting. But that's not to say we wouldn't occasionally sort of come up with some sci-fi, you know, whatever, like think of it like dubstep or Daft Punk or something, we come up with whatever our futuristic like music would be, and we would occasionally have that playing over the radio or something, because that could be kind of cool and immersive.
Chris, hey, a lot of people have asked me about this. We don't have to make a decision on it right now, but players want to create their own radio stations with whatever programming they produce, and it could be a 24-hour stream, and we could potentially integrate that into our game and play the basically amateur streams, but they're in fiction radio broadcasts. Does that seem something you'd want to do?
Yeah, no, I think that'd be really cool. I mean, I think that would probably
be sort of quite easily supported with the system that I'm talking about anyway, because you're basically just plugging into sort of audio streams. But yeah, that would definitely be cool. I mean, that's part of the idea. Part of the idea would be that, you know, yes, we're guiding the world and we're sort of designing on a big scale, but a lot of the content and the drama, like what's happening, is coming from the players. So, you know, that's great. I mean, you know, like the stuff that the community's done so far is amazing, just the level of videos and care and all the stuff they put into it. And I definitely think that would be, you know, people could have, you know, whatever. They, you know, maybe you buy a license to have your own, like, radio broadcast station, and, you know, instead of selling some, like owning a store to sell stuff, that's what you do, you know. I don't know, I mean, it could be pretty cool.
A radio DJ.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, I'm constantly amazed that in something like Star Citizen, people are really focused on all this huge variety of roles, right? I tend to be a little sort of narrow-minded wink man of privateer. Oh, I just want to be, you know, Luke Skywalker, I want to be Han Solo, but, you know, there's plenty of people that want to, you know, they just want to, like, they want to be the guy that goes out to fix people when they break down in space, or, you know, they want, like, would want to be a VJ, you know, or whatever it would be. It's just, it's amazing how people want to do so many different things, and so it's almost like just going to a different world and reality, and so I think the more we do to support that, especially when it's technically easy, is a good thing for the game.
Hey, let's get it back to our music question, since Pedro's sitting there falling asleep.
No, I'm fine here. Don't worry.
A user who'd like to know if you use any granular synthesis in composing.
What do you mean by synthesis? Like a synthesizer itself, or?
I think electronics to simulate.
Yeah, I do use many synthesizers. I'm a fan of many. I've worked with Rob Pappen a lot, like designing his, helping him in his synths. I think if people are asking that, so they probably know Predator Blue. And he's these are synths that I really like. I really do like Zebra from UHE, Zebra and Diva a little bit as well, but I like Zebra a lot. Massive from Native Instruments is great. And of course, there's also the Moogs, which I really, Moog Little Fatty, it's a synthesizer. I really love the sound of it. We still, since we're focusing on the score of Squadron 42 and what we have in mind, at least for now, it's more like the classic sci-fi sound in that. We want it to be like a cinematic experience. We don't want it to be like too experimental. We want people to play the Squadron 42 storyline and feel like, oh, this reminds me of things from that we lived before in the past 10 years or 20 years. So Squadron 42 has a more classy sci-fi scoring than more accessible, more heartwarming music to me. I'm not saying that synthesizers are not heartwarming, which are to me, but maybe they're not for the majority of people. I think almost everyone loves hearing a beautiful string section playing a theme with a lot of expression, and it will fit perfectly in a sci-fi score, in my opinion. Then there will be, of course, as we have spoke before, with all the different landscapes and planets and things like that, we will progressively integrate synthesizers. The main theme already has some synthesizers in there, and in the more more strange planets, if I may say so, we might go more experimental in terms of music. It's like as Chris said, it's like an ongoing experience during time, and we will build a game with all of us, literally with all of us, all the team and all every player, and so. Let's see what the future is holding for us.
I'm also wondering if there will be non-orchestral ambient music in space.
Yes, I
non-orchestral.
We right now we are focusing on the orchestral score, but I always say something about music, which is, for me, there are only two kinds of music, which is good and bad music. I try to make the good music. But now, what defines good music is just good writing. It doesn't have to be with orchestra. Orchestra I love orchestra personally, but it doesn't have to be always orchestra. There might be some corners of the galaxy where the orchestra will not fit at all. But as I said, it's with time, we will discover in which ways we should use orchestra or not. I believe, I don't know.
So yeah, I mean, there was even
piece that we haven't shared yet, but there was some exploration of kind of like almost a mood in a nebula that you did a while ago, Pedro, and that was pretty much all. It was all synth, and it was sort of felt appropriately synth, right? Which is the sort of stuff you couldn't necessarily do on with orchestral. So I would say that. Well, I was just saying that. I mean, I would just say that we use a combination of even when the orchestral stuff, you still have some synth elements because there's a sound with a certain synth sound that you don't get with an orchestral instrument. So we combine those, and some places it may be mostly orchestral, and some places it may be more synth, and we may have some places where it just could be sort of a soundscape versus necessarily something that's melodic. So I guess the answer would be yes.
Which great.
This might be our final question, I think, coming up. All right.
Wondering if there will be a choir used.
Yes, of course. There will be a choir. The main theme already has a choir.
Your requiem that you did was pretty beautiful with the choir.
I believe that there is no best instrument as the human voice. It's the best instrument that exists. Also, it's the hardest one to actually score well without always being the traditional staccato, there are many ways to use the voice. Like, there are so many ways to use the voice. If you hear many modern classical composers like Luciano Berio and or even far back in history, composer like Okegan or Josquin des Prez, and you'll hear just so many ways to use the choir. And I hope that the main team already has a choir, but I hope that we will explore the void, human voice, and perhaps sometimes disguising in a way that no one will ever tell it's a human voice. And I think I like to do that, at least. I like to do it.
We should warn Andrew that before he goes to bed.
Yeah.
Our fans crashed his site.
Fine.
Our fans crashed his site.
Apparently,
and crashing the Star Citizen, our fans have now crashed your site because they've all gone there to check it out.
My God. My wife said.
You should be proud.
Cool. So.
That's why I was not able to upload anything. I was trying to upload and I couldn't. Like, oh my God, what? Never mind. Sorry. Well, yeah, crash. Don't worry. That means I must change my server. I thought I had a dedicated server. Guess I don't have it after all.
Yeah, you need more than one. You need a whole load balancing server to distribute to subservers and everything.
Well, we can visit YouTube.
Ben, you got
one more. I think we're coming close to the next section. So let's take one more.
What sort of instruments will be used in the music? But what instruments have been used in the music we recorded so far? Is it primarily brass or strings or what?
Well, I am personally a fan of woodwinds and strings. But of course, the horns and the brass family of an orchestra, and by tradition, came from the hunters. So when it's impossible to make a track that you want to have some heroic or some
military
or military feeling, that you completely remove the brass. You can if you use some synthesizers instead of brass and things like that, but there is a necessity for that. But what I really will like to use in my music is to always feature the colors of the woodwinds. Many times we neglect that family of the orchestra. So I hope people enjoy that color, and it makes a difference for them.
All right, are we off?
All right. Well, thank you very much for answering some musical questions.
Thank you.
Very welcome.
Thank you. Welcome.
Bye, everyone.
They say goodbye.
Bye. Thank you for crashing my website.
All right. Next up, we're going to bring in some of the team here in Austin to talk about what we're doing out here.
So give them a ring right now. You want to roll and gather them up?
Yep, they are ready to come in. Unfortunately. We'll have them in just a moment. So, anybody want to buy an Idris?
Do I need to run again?
It's Brendan.
Hi. All right. Am I on? Awesome people.
Yep.
Forrest, yeah. Forrest, Brian, Brendan.
Brian's not here.
Brian's.
Yeah, well, Brian's here.
All right. Well, Forrest to do.
Oh.
All right. Maybe Aaron. All right, we've got Forrest and Brendan here to talk about some of the work we are doing in Austin. What kind of work are you doing right now in Austin?
Well, we're concentrating on PBR rendering to give our whole engine a graphical facelift. We're concentrating on our environments and how we're going to build out so many environments in a reasonable amount of time. So we're concentrating on this modular tier system.
Mm-hmm.
And then,
So tell me more about PBR. This is the first everybody's hearing about that. What is it?
Do you want to give the programmer a lecture on PBR?
Sure. PBR is kind of, we approach we refactor the way we approach art so that we're aiming to make objects react naturally to light. So we can express surface materials better. Our metals should look a lot better. Our plastics, our leathers, everything should look a whole lot closer to the way they do in reality and react to varying light conditions pretty well.
So on the game art side, one of the big changes is the difference between how we do our specular maps. Before, you kind of just fake your diffuse texture into looking like a specular map, and there's really no realistic approach to how you do your specular maps. And now we're able to fake a real index of refraction through the specular map, which allows our metals to react react to light as it should in the real world. It allows our plastics to do the same. It allows our flat materials, just basic diffuse materials like concretes, bark.
We're getting asked, what does it stand for? So PBR stands for physically based rendering. We're aiming to match the real world reactions of materials as we light our levels. Just things should look much closer to the way they do in the real world.
And it looks spectacular. We're gonna show you a little bit of that in the near future. Just the improvement it's gonna make just in the Hangar modules is just incredible.
Chris, I think we have a video that will show when it's finished downloading onto the broadcast machine here, which is in progress of about 10 minutes. It's the one Nathan sent that I think has some element of the PBR in it as well Kind of some cool stuff on the Avenger. The Avenger is much more developed than what's in the Hangar right now.
Right, yeah, awesome. The Avenger has actually been completely ported over to the PBR, so that'll be a great look at the improvement of our rendering.
Another advantage it has is, I don't know if I'm on camera, maybe do the chair thing. Do you grab that chair and I'll take the chair for us?
Yep.
I'll switch the chair this way. Is the assets, allow us to reuse assets in different lighting situations better, so it kind of increases art efficiency also.
Well, it increases the art direction, as in things will be much more consistent across the board, and so you'll have a consistent art direction. And everything will make look much more fluid and more like just one environment, looks as it should, instead of like sporadically have different art styles all over the place.
So, talk about this modular work you're doing.
What's the story there? We're basing our environment on what we're calling a modular tier system. And what that means is we break it up into multiple tiers. So it can be tier one, tier two, tier three, tier four, tier five. The smaller it is, the more individual it is, the bigger it is, the more grouped amount of assets there are. So maybe you have a giant building that's broken up into modular prefabs, and you want to take all those modular prefabs, you could assemble them in the engine, and then you could just boom, prefab all those prefabs together, and now all of a sudden you have a giant building that you can just build in the scene. And also you go inside of it and then break it down in different ways and looks and forms, so you can build out different environments very quickly with the same amount of assets.
I can't see you.
So you can. It allows us to build out things in a modular fashion very quickly.
Is that better?
Bionna?
Council?
Saving the day.
Could I decline or just.
Decline whatever that is.
Nobody can see the camera.
Yeah, okay, now you guys are in there.
Yeah. Brendan's a little cut off.
Oh, we were getting like this half forest.
That's more than
I got.
Yeah, that's plenty.
Plenty of forest.
Right. Nothing but my beard in this scene.
You want to talk about the hangar?
We can talk about the hangar, sure.
Yeah, yeah. You are the wingman. So what have we been working on here in our house?
Well, as Chris talked about earlier, we have a lot of people working on dogfighting, but we also are working on what we're going to be doing in the hangar. We've scheduled for two updates. You can't see me at all. That's okay. It's okay. Mike, don't worry about it. Okay? I'm right there. I'm right over here. Don't worry about me. All right. Fine.
There we go.
We're all the same. All right. I guess good chance too. So it'll be a couple updates coming up. We're looking at what we're going to put into the hangar. We don't want to tell people what it's going to be, but we've got some pretty cool stuff I think they're going to like, some stuff for the holidays, some secret stuff, and you know, and as Forrest said, we're working on the tier system, and we're also working on the asteroid hangar. We just did a redesign with a ziggurat style of hangars.
Working on the Cutlass, is that?
Cutlass is ongoing. We are in the process of fixing the landing gear on that, and hopefully we'll get that in the hangar before Christmas.
That's the thing you want, is to have your ship show up without landing gear.
Yeah, well, you know, it can hover forever.
So you're expecting a hangar patch before Christmas?
Yeah, we're hoping to have two hangar patches before Christmas.
Hangar, you heard it here first, folks.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
All right. So Forrest was telling us about this modular system working on that's going to improve work here.
Everyone.
So I think
right now. Yeah, I mean, that's a pretty big deal, right? It's going to have sliders and abilities to, you know, help us create the landing zones and the planet stuff, give us a, you know, an overview of what's going to be in there. Think like Dungeon Master, where you kind of, you know what's going on around the economy of the planet and what the population's going to look like, and you should be able to create a first version with the tier system or with the overall system there, and then the guys can go through and hero it out, make it look really good.
Now, Outlaw 78 wants to make sure we work on bug fixes. Is that
bug fix? We don't have any bugs.
Oh,
come on.
Oh, okay.
We have some documented features. Chris has already told us we are not allowed to have any bugs. So
we are always working on bugs.
Yeah, always,
all the time. Get bug stuff all the time, and we're always just kind of prioritize it based on importance.
Unfortunately, we also introduced new bugs because we have so much of the game in development and so many things changing and so much new code and functionality coming in. The new bugs appear, so we're also work on new bugs and try to keep it so that new bugs don't get out and fix it before you see them. Of course, something will
go on, Chris.
Hey, on the side, right? I mean, we just
switched to a new system. I'm not sure that it's being affected on our deployment, but we now have different branches based on release versions. Whereas before, we didn't necessarily have that, and that was one of the big issues why the Hornet got delayed, was that we had code that was being done for another part of the, you know, like the dogfighting, that broke some hangar stuff. And that's one of the reasons why we pushed that hangar when, you know, there was the big drama about the Hornet being delayed. But now what we do is we have sort of branches, so we'll branch when we're ready to do a release, say in the hangar, that can branch off and it can be separate to what's happening on the dogfight. And that's more and more important because we've got, you know, not just dogfight and hangar, but we've got dogfight, hangar, you know, first person, boarding, planet side, Squadron 42, and then in some ways we have also a separate, you know, also even the back end stuff that you're working on, that's really kind of another branch as well, right, Jason? So there's a lot of different code that's sort of going up, and that's one of our challenges is how to constantly be delivering code and keeping existing bases that people are using on the public side stable, but also allowing us to be doing R&D while maintaining live stuff. So that's something we're actively continually trying to improve that process and even staff up more people so we can maintain those multiple code bases.
Yeah. And to piggyback on what you're saying, to clarify a little bit for the folks who aren't used to development, when we branch
something, we usually branch off a certain subset of things that the features that are in the thing, and then what happens after we release it, then we go back and consolidate those fixes back in and fix those bugs. So it's kind of like you're branching streams off and always bringing it back in, which is a little different. Usually we fix a lot of the stuff at the end, but we're doing this all along the way. So, yeah. And since all the modules and everything are all part of one game, so yeah, we try to do it as frequently possible, bring everything back together,
right,
to try to prevent bugs we might miss if they've stayed apart for a long time.
And we use Jira, we track all that stuff, we're bug crushing all the time.
Tell me about this asteroid hangar. How cool is it?
Well, it's pretty cool. You know, the idea initially is it is going to, I think Chris can correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe this is something we're toying with the idea of eventually being the guild style hangar where it builds out down to where you're sitting up top. And you're going to be able to look kind of at an angle. If you know what a ziggurat pyramid is or a step down pyramid, each, like the top level is a keystone, it's relatively small. So if you just have a cutlass and you're up top, that's all you see. But if you start having things, bigger ships to put in there, then you'll open up larger areas looking out. So you'll actually be able to look out and see down levels of ginormous amounts of ships.
Yeah, it feels like as opposed to before where the hangars just kind of modularly
scaled
up.
Scaled out
lengthwise. Now it kind of feels like it's actually being built into the asteroid.
Right, exactly.
It's kind of different and kind of, you know, pretty cool, right?
Yeah.
Especially for that type of hangar. It works pretty well.
Yeah, it looks pretty good. We white boxed it out, and now we're, white boxing stuff because it just looks like a white box, but we know it fits now, and now we got to make it look like it's hewn out of rock, and it looks like it's, you know, you're in an asteroid somewhere.
I don't know if any of our backers have whole pyramids worth of ships.
I know Rad does.
But if they did?
Sandy's got, like, all kinds of people that have tons of ships out there. It's amazing.
Screenshots from this.
That's exactly right. And that's kind of, you know, that's a good point, Ben. It's really fun for us when we release these things to see the videos that the fans create in their hangars and the things they're doing. I mean, the one guy had like a 24-hour fish cam going, and then Rad had his drive-around buggy down his, you know, his full car lot of ships. You know, that's pretty amazing.
Yeah, there was a guy who did all those commercials. I wanted to buy
anything FPS.
So, yeah,
that guy's amazing. Yeah, I contacted him directly. I like him a lot.
Very cool stuff. And of course, Austin is helping out with dogfighting, right?
It is. That's a big deal for us. And, you know, Chris talked about that earlier. So
I'm spending a lot of time on dogfighting right now, mm-hmm. Building out the environment and then all of the effects that'll go along with the ship.
Yeah, the effects that go along with all the weapons, everything, and then the sounds that go with those, and then how much damage they do, and then, you know, the damage textures and the looks and all that stuff to do. You know, we don't want to put something out there that's too early. We want to make sure
it's done right.
Yeah,
if you're gonna do it right.
But you know, there might be something coming where they can fire weapons pretty quickly. We'll see how that goes. I don't know anything about that either.
All right, let's take some questions for the Austin team.
Chris knows about that.
Let's see. The fish in the hangar, will they be more alien in the future?
You know, that's a great question. You know, and we've, you don't want to give too much away here, but Let's just say before Christmas, he might have an answer to that question.
And it's no, they're not going to be any more fish.
What are you talking about? They're Earth-like planets. Everything's Earth.
Yeah, so I keep checking your tanks.
Yeah, keep checking your tanks.
Let's see. How does the modular system work with NPCs, unique, and non-static objects?
Well, you can have dynamic objects built into the tier system in general. For example, I mean, you could go as far as, say, if you had a tier system that was built around a bar, right? And you could drop that tier into the center of a room, and then it automatically creates a prefab or a template bar. And you could have kind of an NPC built into that that's maybe the bartender. And then, again, the whole beauty of it is jumping into it and then swapping out the different aspects of the tier system because it's made up of multiple prefabs. And then when you swap that stuff out, right, that's where you get your customized feel. So it's not going to be a modular system that everything looks the same.
Right.
It's a modular system that gives you a very quick template to start building everything out and prototyping everything. And then as you look at it, you can see what needs to be changed. And maybe, you know, maybe it's a different type of planet, so you plop it down, then you switch out the assets for the appropriate art design that fits that style of planet. So
sure.
That's kind of the idea.
Yeah, I mean, where's the planet located? Is it close to the Xi'an? Is it close to the
right.
to Terra? I mean, there's all kinds
of
things.
What kind
of
species
influence.
Should
yeah.
your bartender be?
Absolutely,
so
all that
kind
stuff.
Of ties into
it needs to be. And we have a lot of places to go, so it's and it's going to be continuing on forever. Hopefully,
right.
we'll be adding mm-hmm. systems and planets forever.
Right.
We've got someone wondering if there will be more things for our NPCs to do in the hangar. Are there going to be living quarters?
NPCs to do in the hangar?
Well, I mean, if we have multiple characters, can somebody be taking a nap while the other one is
shaving his eyebrow?
Yeah.
Do what?
NPC group.
Yeah, I guess you know, barracks kind of thing. Mm-hmm. You know, yeah, I guess that might happen at some point. You don't want to give too much away, but
it's going to be more than just a box to keep our ships in.
Yeah, no, the hangar's meant to be a living quarters, right? It's meant to be your place, your living space. And a lot of until we have persistence, which will allow us to, you know, right now everything's set in a certain location, from posters to buggies to fish tanks to everything else that's in a certain location each hangar. Eventually, we're going to let you customize that and move it around. I believe is it client side customizations coming first, Jason? Correct?
Probably, yeah.
So at that point, then we've got to have a UI that allows people to move stuff around. And, then you'll start seeing a lot more stuff come in, or, you know, that will allow you to have slots. You to basically customize your own hangar. Because ultimately, it needs to feel like your house.
And I don't know, is it safe to say that there's a reason why we put doors in the hangar?
Yeah, well, yeah, I think that's safe to say.
Right?
Yeah.
All right. So what about graphical improvements? Under the hood, what's going on?
Can we talk about PBR at all?
We just kind of briefly touched about it.
They're going to have a video for us soon that's going to show.
Yeah, at Inside CIG, Moreland and Forrest,
right.
Everybody's cut together.
Nathan.
We've got a video coming
Nathan's,
up.
Nathan's doing. Oh, man,
is it the engine?
No, it's he's.
Oh,
she's
doing.
The
we're doing the PBR. Sorry, my
bad. One thing that I see coming up a lot, we are going to do an optimization pass on the hangar. And
yes.
We are going to go through and do LODs and
lighting.
Do a major optimization pass. And a lot of the lighting is kind of temporary at the time, and it will be improved. And really, I think all of those changes will be a part of the porting to the PBR process. So it'll kind of all, I think, happen at once. Instead of being redundant and doing it twice,
yeah.
I think we're trying to all fit it into one schedule. That way we can, you know, do
yeah,
it as
you know,
efficient as possible.
It's hard to describe. I mean, the first time I saw the difference in PBR May was in that thruster you were working on, and it's phenomenal, people. It's not just kind of better. It's, I mean, our ships look amazing already. We've got talented modelers, concept people making some amazing stuff. But PBR just takes it to a whole nother level. And wow.
It's not a PC game, but if anyone's checked out the videos on Rise, I mean, Rise is one of the first commercial games using physically based rendering. And that's why the outfits, the metal, the fabrics, they all look much more realistic than they traditionally do in a game. And the advantage of PBR is that... What? Well, yeah, so...
You're the only one they can hear.
Okay, good. So they can't hear you, Eric, so you can zip it and let me talk. But the issue with PBR is that it means that your lighting is the same. So like traditionally in different areas, different materials, an artist would do one set of materials, another artist would do a different set of materials. And then under the, if you took a model built by one artist and you put it in a different environment, it would look radically different. And it would, you know, and so you would have to adjust that. PBR basically has it consistent across because it's all reacting physically. So essentially this metal look that you would get on a ship is consistent across everywhere, which is really important for us because we have so many different environments, so many different lighting conditions. And they react more realistically to the lighting effect. So I think it's a big thing. I mean, the video, we're literally waiting for it to get converted. Can't take MOVs, it can only take MP4s. So right now we're compressing a video that we made with the Avenger that is an upgrade over the Avenger that's sitting in the current hangar with more features, and also converted over to use our early version of PBR. So there you go.
We've also related to performance, we're working on some more longer term architectural changes and written rendering and such. For all of our very customizable modular ships, create a lot of draw calls, a lot of state changes. So we're working on some long-term things to efficiently render lots of those. So we'll have a good frame rate with lots of modular customized ships on screen.
And I saw a question go by about the office move. Would you give us an update on that?
Yeah, actually the lease is being signed today, I hope. It's in Herr Roberts' inbox, so he's got to sign it. And once it's signed, we move in on the 20th.
It's signed, Eric. It's already signed. It was signed yesterday.
There you go. Chris is all way ahead of the game, as usual. And 28th of December is what it's looking like.
Awesome. As you can tell, we are pressed for space right now. So.
Yes.
Can you tell us about the new office?
The folks have seen it. It's a pretty large space. It's going to give us room to set up a small mocap area to grow the team some, to where we can continue to release things and integrate these bits and pieces that are coming from all over the different studios. So it's in a nice location. Just like Santa Monica has a beautiful area, we're getting out of the basement, essentially. Yeah.
So I hear that we
good to play the video on the Avenger, which uses sort of the preliminary PBR shading stuff. So I think we'll
play that now. This
Nathan Gearsley, who's incredibly talented. He's the guy that actually designed and built the Avenger. He actually works in the UK, so he's part of our sort of UK operation. He did the buggy as well, by the way. So he has a lot of experience with CryEngine as well, because he was at Crytek UK for a long time before he joined us. So he's a talented guy. So I think we're going to queue up the video, play it, and then maybe we can answer some questions afterwards, and then we'll roll on to Sandy's update. Okay, here we go. Can I see what this video looks like? Can I come over to you? I see it. I'm off. Never mind.
Thank you.
Anyway, so what are we at? Are we sold? That was the upgraded Avenger using sort of the early version of the PBR. So hopefully you'll like that. I think we'll put that up on our YouTube channel, so it'll be slightly higher res than what we can do in the live stream. But hopefully you guys liked it. I think maybe we could take a couple of questions on any specific PBR stuff, and then we can jump and Sandi can give an update on what we're doing with cons and merchandise and all the rest of stuff. So Ben, you want to hit a few more PBR related questions? And
I can give a shout. Everybody is just going crazy about the Avenger right now. I think
I was going crazy. I had to run out and see the video myself.
Yeah, we lost Eric and Jason because they went crazy.
Like, it's definitely going to be a bounty hunter's shit.
It takes a, you don't have to redo any of the geometry or any of the model. However, the way you break down your texture sets is entirely different. So that does take a little bit of time.
Does PBR mean a performance hit?
Wow.
Generally.
It generally, no. Does not.
Not in modern generation graphics cards.
Is it going to increase the time to make a new ship live going forward, or is it just a matter of a different process
now? So I think Chris hit it right on the head in the fashion that I think it'll save us time, because instead of somebody trying to do stuff from scratch all the time, we have a set of material libraries that this is Chrome, this is Lunamon, and so on and so forth, that people can just pull for it and then kind of define it. So there'll be a lot of materials that are already made that people start at, so it might even save us time.
Yeah, I mean, I
think we haven't updated the hangar for a little bit right now. One of the reasons is when we shift to PBR, it's a complete like shift to PBR, so we have to change everything over because the way you do the materials. So it's another example of a short-term hit for a long-term gain. So, you know, we've made the decision that considering the range and the scope of all the environments, all the lighting conditions, all the different things we've got, you know, PBR, outside of the fact we just think it looks better because you know, the lighting reaction just looks more like a real material, is it's going to make it much easier for us to balance stuff in the long term. But obviously we've got to switch all our assets over to it, so I'm not quite sure when we're pulling the trigger, because we don't quite have the final PBR implementation, and we have an early work in progress one. We're in the process of integrating the essentially sort of the more recent PBR, which was what Rise shipped with. But with that, we will obviously have to take all our assets in the hangar and all the ships we've done and switch them PBR materials versus the traditional stuff, which will take a bit of time. But once that's done down the road, as Farah said, everything's much easier because it's standard. We don't have to like worry about tweaking materials for like four different conditions, and then we build another environment and we put something in it and it looks crap, and so we have to go back and tweak the material again, which is generally the process that's happened with the old material system. So it will be better, and like Farah says, you know, at some point, yeah, you've got the chrome, you've got the brushed metal, you've got the leather and all that sort of there, and so we're really excited by it. I mean, it's all about making the environments be more immersive and real. Like I said, the Avenger is a nice example of some early stuff, but it's going to look better than that even down the road. So I'm good right now.
Very good stuff. We're going to get that video up for everybody to see for kind of live stream. So.
All right. Well, thank you guys
very
much for taking some time off.
Cool. Let's get back to work.
Yeah.
Have fun, guys.
Right. So now I think
we're
going to
talk about
what we're doing.
CitizenCon? Xi'an?
Yeah.
You got to go this way.
Get back to the lamp.
Do you want to
get remove the lamp?
Yeah.
Let's put the lamp on the other side.
Come on the other side.
So I researched CitizenCon as Berlin, if you didn't know, was the clear winner. However, for the amount of people that responded to the poll, I had to look for venues that were at least 3,000 or 4,000 people. And for the whole month of October, everything is fully booked for 2014. So we are waitlisted for a couple of venues for 2015. However, 2014 in Berlin is not going to happen. Having said that, we have looked into other events so that we can go around the world, essentially, and every country can kind of get their shot.
Yeah, I think we decided, right, it would be better to pick some key events around. So instead of everyone having to travel in one location, we'll do something in Europe, something mm-hmm. in North America, something in
PAX Australia. We are going to do.
There you go, something in Australia, and so that way you can get maybe reach the widest range because you know Star Citizen's completely, you know, it's amazing. I mean, we're not just you know North American. We're everywhere, right? So we're global, and so we really want to try to have opportunities to interact directly with everyone around the world. So we thought this was maybe a better way. So we're going to do a dedicated event at various places. I think PAX.
PAX Australia, which is October 31st to November 2nd. We don't know exactly what we're going to do yet, but we will do an event that does not require a ticket to get into PAX. A lot of people have been asking. I am looking into us putting together a panel for PAX Australia. One of our kind Aussie fans sent me a link. So we're going to look into that. Dragon Con we're going to do again. Ben and Dave Haddock really enjoyed their time this year. So we're going to do that one again. That's August 29 to September 2. We are going to do Gamescom again, which is August 14 to August 17. Probably something similar to what we did this year. I'm not sure how many venues there are that are bigger than the one that we had this year. So we'll do our best. To accommodate. And then I'm looking into PAX East, and hopefully we get the venue. I've just, we're on the wait list, but hopefully I'll know in a few days if we get a venue for PAX East, which is April 11 to 13. What else? That's it, right? North America, Europe, and Australia. So that's the con list. The CitizenCon list. CitizenCon next year will be in Los Angeles, something a little bigger than what we did this year, but I'm not sure how big we can make it. I also looked into Las Vegas. The cost to actually hire a venue in Berlin or in Vegas is stupidly expensive. Just for the venue hire.
Like hundreds of thousands of dollars.
Like hundreds of thousands of dollars.
Which is probably why, like, if you go BlizzardCon, they charge you, I don't know what it is, $175 a ticket, because they have the same kind of, like,
Well, I went to BlizzCon this year, and they have 30,000 people that go through for $175 a ticket, and it's a whole process in itself, so we would need to hire a whole dedicated team and everything, and it's probably...
We've got a game to make.
We do have a game to make, so it's probably not viable for 2014. We have the Starship final, next Great Starship, which will be on June 8th, and I have to check the capacity for that, but we will probably have fans as winners who can come to the event. I'm not sure how we're going to run that yet. I think the capacity is maybe less than 1,000, so... but that will be in Los Angeles, the Next Great Starship Final, which brings me to some stats for the Next Great Starship Final. We have a total of 111 teams who have entered right now. 26 teams from the US, 8 teams from the UK, 5 teams from Germany, 4 teams from Australia, 4 teams from Canada, 2 from Spain, 2 from Switzerland, 2 from Austria, 1 from Norway, 1 from the Netherlands, 1 from New Zealand, 1 from Argentina, 1 from Russia, 1 from China, woohoo, 1 from Italy, 1 from Greece, and 1 from Russia.
Okay, so 2 from Russia.
Oh, 2 from Russia, yeah. Okay. And then we've got people who've entered, they work in the industry.
And you've got 49 unspecified country
teams,
yes,
we
right,
do.
So.
Thank you for reading my sheet of
paper.
Well,
no, I'm just saying, because then we'll probably add all that up and go, that's not 111 people.
Yeah, all right. People who've worked in the industry, so we've got people from all sorts of backgrounds, including Disney and Paradigm and Ubisoft and all sorts. People who work at Walmart, cool. Teams consisting of best friends and fathers, that'd be interesting. We actually have quite a few teenagers who've entered. 3D artists who work for the nation's defense building simulation, building simulations. That's cool. Active duty army men, heads of IT departments, self-taught 3D modelers, design companies, hobbyists, enthusiasts, amateurs, and freelancers. So it should be a pretty cool competition. We have, of course, our very own Chris Roberts judging.
Me too. And we have our Austin Art team who right now are all actually, since in America it's Thanksgiving this week, so a lot of people take off a day or two early because we take Thursday, which is Thanksgiving, is obviously a holiday, and then Friday's a holiday, so it's a long weekend, and people take off. So actually Mark Skelton, who's our Austin Art Director, is off today, and I think Chris Olivier worked late last night, but they both will be on the judging panel, and Chris Smith, who's our lead vehicle modeler, who's done an amazing job. I mean, the Hornet rebuild and design and all that sort of stuff was all his. The 300i was what he modeled. He's also off for this week for his sort of long extended Thanksgiving holiday for all the hard work he's been doing, cranking out stuff for the hangar and the game. So, but they'll all be part of the panel, and then we'll get some other sort of industry people in or celebrities to judge, and it should be fun. And we're going to try and make it fun, and
every Friday,
yeah, should be good.
And then what else we got going? Mouse pads arrived. Just in case you're wondering what this is, I saw somebody thought it was a big magazine. It is actually a massive mouse pad.
Can we see it?
Look at that.
And we, I think we currently, oh, look at that. Oh, I can see. There you are, sitting on it.
mouse pads, polo shirts are ready to ship. So they will start shipping on Thanksgiving Day to everybody who ordered a polo shirt. My hoodie samples just arrived, for those of you who saw this earlier. So we're just going through quality on these.
Oh, don't worry.
Well, it's a bit small for you, Chris. But.
Is this the baby one? Yeah, we can
see it. That's a medium.
Medium. There we go.
Yeah, it's slightly short in the arms, but that is a medium.
So, let's see.
For all of you who live in cold climates other than Australia.
Trek Interplanetary right here. There you go. And redacted on the back. And we may do some of the swords on the side of the skull and crossbones. So, good for everyone in cold, rainy Europe at the moment.
Yeah. That, Canada, everybody probably except Australia and maybe some. Thank you. What else? Somebody asked about t-shirts. We will have another design out for that. The three new mouse pad artworks are ready.
Yes, we have what we have.
The Aegis, the Misk, and the
Aegis, Misk, and where we at?
Origin.
We already have Origin, Anvil, and RSI. So Aegis, Misk, and there's a third one that I don't know why I'm blanking on.
Drake,
yay!
Yes, as in the thing. Yes, correct.
So they're ready, and I think the subscribers voted for the Aegis one first, so that's going to be exclusive to them first, and then what's left will go to other peeps.
Cool.
A few more patches are coming. What else we got? Oh, coffee mugs. I just saw them, samples of them, which are pretty cool. So we'll get them to the office, and then we'll try them out here and see if everybody likes them and they wash well and stuff. So that's about it from me, I think.
Okay, any questions for Sandi? Should we get a few?
Yeah, anybody out there best for
Sandi, just let me know in the chat wall. Somebody asking about polo shirts. They're shipping starting Thanksgiving Day. Someone's wondering about a Star Citizen joystick. Is that something we might be looking into in the future?
I have been talking to SciTech, and I think we want to put out a poll to see what people think, what they would like to use, and if they like that brand, and then we can go from there.
Yeah, SciTech are pretty keen to do a dedicated Star Citizen joystick. We talked about some things we would like, so to be able to have the ability to sort of look around in an analog way as well as using a joystick. We have a whole bunch of nice SciTech stuff they sent us. I mean, everyone's been great. Razer, SciTech, all the Logitech, all the peripheral folks. But yeah, it'd be fun to do a specific Star Citizen joystick. So so yeah, I'd love to hear your guys' thoughts on that.
The chat right now, they're very excited.
They're stuck
in the chat
room
right now.
And be sure to vote in the poll.
And then we'll know how much interest is out there so that we can create something specific for everybody.
We've got folks wondering about dog tags, citizen cards, and slippers.
Had not thought about slippers, but I can look into it. What else? Dog tags. I'm sampling those. I'm just a bit concerned about the ones I've received. When they get wet, how they work on the skin. I don't want stuff that affects your skin badly. So that's being worked on. What else? What did you say? Dog tags, citizen cards. The replacement run is taking a lot longer than we expected because it's really difficult to program through the site because each card is custom. So we hope to send out those forms in the first week of December. But please do not hit up customer service in the meantime because we're swamped right now. So.
All right, any other questions for Sandi, guys? They're all shouting out suggestions for products. They want stickers, backpacks, 3D ships, towels, bathrobes, fish, bumper stickers.
And your own mutant stuff is a fish.
I think we're actually on our schedule now. We're going to do the HUD stuff, right? Is that the plan?
Yeah, that's
the plan. Okay, so we're going to show you. This is a sort of behind the scenes video we put together talking about our HUD workflow. I think you guys will enjoy it, and then we'll have I think Zane in who's now back in Austin, but he's coming back out here to LA, and then Brandon will be here, and I'll be here, and we can talk about some of the stuff that you've seen in this video that we're going to roll right now. So enjoy the video, and see you in a few minutes.
Hey everybody, I'm here with Johnny Likens, our UI designer. Johnny, would you like to introduce yourself to everybody?
I'm John Likens. I'm a UI designer, and I've been brought onto the project to head up all the design and UI elements inside the ships that you'll be interacting with when you're playing the game.
Can you tell us how you came to Cloud Imperium Games?
So my background is in film and television, and I got a call from Travis, who was referred to me from my work on Iron Man 3, where I did a bunch of the HUD design and UI work in that film. And it was at that point he explained to me what Star Citizen is all about and how the work that I was doing in the film world, you know, could directly be applied to what's happening in the game world.
So you work with Zane and a bunch of the other guys in the office. What is the workflow that you work on for the HUD specifically?
So when I start a project like this, I think it's really important to become quite familiar with whatever it is that you're designing the interface graphics for. For example, the Hornet, you know, I'm creating the HUD and all the interface sort of design elements for it, and I believe that, you know, it should be cohesive and feel like it's part of the same system. You know, the design aesthetic of the ship should be reflected in the UI. I started out by just sort of flying around the ship, getting a sense for some of the design work and the line work that's already been built into the ship. You know, just taking notes from some of the forms and shapes that have already been created for this particular asset. From there, I'll just do a lot of sketches, and I'll be very loose and very fast-paced with sort of getting a lot of ideas out on paper, and then I'll just like loosely either scan in those sketches from the book, or I'll just come in here and draw, you know, freehand on top of the plate and vectorize it and make everything clean and nice and work with a grid and do all my typeface exploration in Illustrator and solidify all those ideas that were executed in the sketching process.
it's different just because in film, you know, all the UI and stuff, it's all just fake and we get to sort of, you know, make it up as you go. But in the game environment, all these things have to have a purpose and they have to have meaning and they have to sort of, you know, function as an aid to the player.
So I worked on the design for about a week and a half and then worked on the animation for a few days, and that's kind of brought us to where we're at. But there's also been a lot that's kind of gone into it just to get to this point. For example, if you see this reticle, it's an actual 3D object. And so taking that vector design that you saw over here, knowing that we want it to fly in and be three-dimensional and then eventually end up looking like this, taking that design that I created, that 2D vector art in Illustrator, I can then bring it into Cinema 4D and extrude all the pieces and place them in their own depth and animate them accordingly. And then I'll be able to export that out for the developers to work it into the game.
So what Johnny's focus is in this whole workflow is to come up with a high-level visual concept of the HUD, which includes the animation of the boot-up sequence and also sort of like the damage states and how that sort of animates. And what my focus is in this workflow is to take that and then animate it so that it gets translated into an in-game asset, which I can then hand over to Brandon.
Zane hands that Flash file off to me, and I plug it into the engine and make sure that the C++ code is interfacing with it properly.
So the cool thing about how we're developing this game is that we're releasing it piece by piece. And so this, for this first dogfighting module, the work that we're doing on this HUD, we'll be able to put it out there to the players and get feedback on that. What things could be improved, what sections of the HUD are readable or not readable, and then we'll be able to fold that feedback into future iterations of the HUD on different ships and even the Anvil HUD.
In Star Citizen, there's not a lot of abstraction in how the ships function. Everything is a real part that actually exists in the system, and all of those parts need to actually communicate with each other. So I've been doing a lot of work to make sure that there's interconnectivity between all of the various ship systems, and making sure that those have a way to communicate with all of the various output devices like the player's HUD.
So our goal is to create a really cool HUD, a really immersive experience. And one of the ways that we're doing this is to actually diversify the visual style of HUD by ship manufacturer. So right now we're sort of initially concepting the visual look and feel and design language for the Hornet, or Anvil Aerospace rather. So you'll see the same style in the Hornet and Gladiator, but later on when we actually get this workflow going and we start fleshing out more HUD designs, they're actually going to be way different. So for in a trading ship, like the Musashi ships, you're going to be able to expect a whole different experience because the visuals language will be different.
Well, there's a lot of systems that are going to be brought into Star Citizen, and you're going to need to interface into all of those. So we're thinking about things like navigation, star maps, things like that, possibly trade interfaces. All of that is going to be done in-world. There won't be any sort of game abstract UI. So there's a lot of stuff to look forward to doing going forward.
One thing what we're doing is we're defining different color spaces that'll be applied to different things. For example, customizability of these different color spaces. So a user can take the red color space or the critical alert color space and assign a different RGB value or color to that so that it's more readable to them.
Coming from, you know, my background, not really being much of a gamer or anything, I sort of offer a fresh perspective and maybe like a new set of eyes, and I would maybe approach problems and tasks in a different way than regular designers in the game industry would, because they sort of know the limitations and they know sort of the boundaries of, you know, where they need to be working in. But for me, I don't really know anything about that, so I'm just kind of, you know, doing my thing, and then we'll work to incorporate it into a, you know, a usable state for gameplay.
Yeah.
just finishing the lovely pizza that was sent to us.
By Thomas Plot.
Yeah. There you go. So, come in. So I hope you guys like that. So I have Brandon here with me, who is doing the programming side. Zane is in Austin, who will be back out.
Back out here to work, and then
Johnny is with us right now because he went back for Thanksgiving. He actually lives in New York, and he's been coming out here and working at our offices here. But yeah, would love to answer questions. I mean, we're pretty excited. I mean, this is just showing you the tip of the iceberg of what we're going to do with the displays and the HUD stuff. But the whole goal with the game is to make everything in the game completely immersive in context of the world, right? So there's no like kind of abstract game UI at all. And when you sit in a cockpit, you get a HUD that you would expect in that cockpit. If you're running around on first person and you grab a pistol, but you don't have a combat outfit on, you have no HUD. If you put a Marine combat outfit in, then a HUD would show up. And yeah, we just want to make it sort of feel like you see in the badass sci-fi movie. Cool. And I think, Zane and Brandon and Johnny have been doing some really pretty exceptional work. And you can't even appreciate how immersive that will be when it's actually in proper stereoscopic 3D. You've got either a 3D monitor or you've got a Rift or something, because then all this stuff will be floating in front of your eyes. But it'll be pretty cool. So, so I guess let's hear some questions. So.
All right, our first question is about alien ships. How different will the HUD be?
So, I mean, the whole idea is that you would diversify the visual language of ship by each manufacturer. So alien ships might have sort of this design language that's radically different than you would have in the human ships. So maybe more along the lines of like different shapes, maybe a different overall color theme to it. We just have to think about that and think of the design language when we start to work on it. So,
yeah, and I'd also say that we're designing the system to be
fairly dynamic and modular. So, like the Hornet, you see but that's a military dogfighting craft. So there's probably a lot more information on the HUD there than maybe if you're flying the Freelancer or the Constellation, where it would be more minimalized, although you could bring up the information. It's just all about when you're in sort of the combat situation in the Hornet, you know you're going to want to know the heat of every one of your weapons and all that sort of stuff. And so the Hornet HUD would be like an example of a HUD that would be sort of more information heavy, and there'll be some that would be less information heavy. The system we're designing is meant to be kind of pretty modular as far as that goes.
People are asking, is it going to be customizable by the user or just by the on our end?
So I think at least one of the things we can do is obviously the color customizability, because that's actually pretty easy. We have different groups of information on the HUD that different color spaces. So generally, the overall color of the HUD is pretty uniform, and that we use color to actually differentiate important elements on the HUD. So things that are important will actually stand out to you. So like the red critical alerts will be red because, that's something that needs your immediate attention right away. It's critical. It's like, really important. So you'll be able to customize that. Some other interaction you can do with the HUD is also minimizing different sections. To just so it clears out sort of the space that you can see around you, sort of like the environment. So if you want to kind of minimize one part of the HUD, you can like cycle through it, and you can minimize it kind of like taskbar minimization, but you'll still kind of see a little bit there, especially if it contains some information. So.
Now, are we going to see this sort of HUD in first-person mode or just in the ships?
We do plan on having some sort of HUD in first person. I think Johnny is actually going out to, or we want Johnny to work with our first person
folks that we haven't announced yet. Yes.
We announced them?
We're going to have, like I said, there's a first person HUD, but it's only if you're wearing like a a suit that would have like a HUD, so augmented reality. You also have what we call Mobi Glass, which is sort of, you know, the futuristic version of, I don't know, a PDA slash augmented reality device. And so those are all things that we're prototyping that would all sort of work together. But they're like, again, they're all sort of work in context. So like the Mobi glasses, I think we're thinking it's mounted on your arm and you pull it up and then it projects in front of you and you sort of, it outlines and projects stuff to you know, kind of tag or show stuff. And if you had like a combat helmet on, you'd get a HUD there. And actually, in fact, in the third person view, if you're looking back at you in the pilot, say in the ship, you can actually see some of the display stuff from the HUD, which is akin to sort of those third person views you saw in, say, Iron Man, when you would look back on Robert Downey Jr., you could see, you know, all the HUD being sort of on the front of his face.
Have you thought about how the HUD is going to look in the Oculus Rift?
I was mentioning the whole stereoscopic 3D side. So we're deliberately setting up all the HUD stuff to have like Z distance, and it actually will be much more immersive in something like Oculus Rift than it would be just on a flat 2D screen, because you really feel the depth. You'll feel like these things floating in front of your eyes before the cockpit glass and stuff.
It's going to be really cool when the HUD actually has a little bit of parallax and delay to it. So when you move your head around, you'll actually, because these user interfaces are projected diegetically in the game, it's sort of separate. It's on a separate bone. So we will kind of try to have some parallax in it, so it just looks, adds to that kind of immersion of you visualizing that interface.
Azrus asks, will we be able to move the location of where elements are displayed on the HUD?
Well, you'll be able to minimize certain things on the HUD, but I don't think we've really looked into like actually moving the different placements of the HUD. That's actually pretty difficult, because when we design the interface, it's like things have to, I mean, especially with the visual language, things have to kind of fit in place.
The code side is not the issue. It's really just like what Zane's talking about, which is the design side, is how we're approaching the HUD. You know, is it like a desktop that you have on a computer where you can move things around, or is it like something that's more, you know, set, and you know, so your speed is on the left but your shields are on the right always. So and that potentially also could be specific to the manufacturer of the ship as well. So but I think the code system supports it. It's just really more a design UI side issue.
Can we use this if you're using scale form as the base?
Brandon?
Yeah, I'm using a scale form, which for people who don't know is a way to design your interfaces in Flash and then bring those into the game and either project them onto surfaces or display them in screen space. So we're actually using both of those aspects. So we have in-cockpit displays, which are flat screens, which you can move in and out, and you can choose what's displayed on them. And we also have the pilot visor, which is a partly a 3D object with a scale form UI projected on it, and partly a screen space scale form UI.
Yeah, and then we're also, it's not, so scale form's part of it, but we're also having actual 3D objects that are rendered with, we're actually developing the shader for them right now. So, but you can see the early versions of it in the hangar with the holo display. So like the ship spinning with the weapons and all that, that's not scale form at all. That's actually the geometry being rendered. So we're using a combination of scale form to do sort of the more sort of 2D elements, the font and the text and stuff. The actual engine to render 3D wireframe objects. So the ship, like for instance, selecting your weapons, that will all be done in the HUD or even on the displays using the actual geometry. Probably the same for damage displays and stuff like that, mainly because we've got so many ships out there and we're building all the geometry. We you don't really want to also have to build a whole separate set of 2D sprites to represent something you've already got in 3D. So we sort of use the geometry engine as well as scale form together in concert to create the effect that we have.
We've got someone asking if HUD is tracking your ship, will it show like an arrow when the ship goes off screen for you to track it?
Yeah, that's something that we do already.
Very cool. A lot of people wondering if the alien HUDs will be in alien languages, if you thought about that yet.
Yeah, I'm not sure. We haven't really got to that point, but I mean, it'd be cool.
Yeah, alien.
I would say, like, flying a Vandal ship, yeah, you're going to have, you know, I mean, we're actually, one thing we're doing right now on the outside is we have some of our graphic artists are actually tasked with developing the look of the alien languages. So I would say the alien ships, unless they were sold, like, built or repurposed for human resale, would defaultly display in an alien language. So, like, if you've got the Drowthi, I mean, not the Drowthi, yes, Wing Commander slipped there, the Sky, you have the Sky, it would basically mostly, it'll be all in Vandal script, wouldn't necessarily be in alphanumeric or anything we've got.
We're wondering if you will see the same HUD in the StarCitizen app that's been talked about. Wondering if that people will be treating their like phone, tablet app as part of their ship and will have the same HUD interface.
So you're talking about second screen display, right? I mean, it's not so much the HUD. It's like, okay, I can see my weapons display or my ship status display in my iPad because it's talking to my computer. I mean, I would assume that, I mean, we haven't really sort of done a lot of work on that aspect of it. That's something we're going to do research towards. But I would assume we would obviously follow the same, like, aesthetic. I mean, there's no reason why we would have a different look for that than you would have on your displays in the game.
Yeah, I mean, a different section, we have different sort of categories of information that's actually displayed in the HUD and the Hornet. So such as like weapon, there's a whole window on like weapon systems, and then you're also your like your own ship stats and also like information on your target. So you could kind of like take one of those information windows, and then maybe one idea is to actually pass that off to whatever peripheral screen that you have on the side and have that display along with any other information you have on your HUD. So maybe it's just kind of like something where it just displays extra information to you at the same time because there's so little screen space to work with already as is.
Got users wondering if different positions in the same ship will have different HUDs. So if I'm a turret gunner or a navigator or something like that, I get a different display than the pilot.
Yeah, you should. There are definitely elements of certain seats that other seats don't need. If you're not in like a pilot seat, you don't need a fixed forward reticle. If you're not on a seat that can control weapons, you don't need any sort of targeting HUD. Radar operators might not need the general ship stats. So yeah, there's a lot of different things that different seats may or may not need.
Yeah, and the seats themselves dictate what elements of the HUD they would need. So
I'm coding that up right now.
There you are, from the horse's mouth.
One wondering about voice commands. Will there be any voice control here?
We haven't actually done any work on
although
that.
We're not necessarily against it. I mean, you know, there's there's the next generation Kinect is going to be released for the PC next year. We'll probably take a look at some of the voice recognition there. We'll look at some of the voice recognition on other stuff, and if it makes sense, we're definitely going to use it. I think generally, in some cases, it is actually kind of useful. So we're interested in it, but we're not committing to it just yet. But we'll definitely do, like, we'll play around with it, do R&D, and if we feel like it makes the game better, we'll use it.
Some questions about the Mobi glass. Does everyone always have a Mobi glass? Do you have to wear it at a particular time? How does that fit into our world?
Well, I think the Mobi glass is like your, you know, the modern day equivalent or the futuristic equivalent of having your iPhone or whatever with you. So generally, you would probably have it with you. Maybe you're wearing it like I've got a watch on right now, that kind of setup. I think that's sort of what we're picturing. So most of the time you're wearing it. So I guess if you're wandering around naked, you wouldn't have it, but there's probably not really going to be any occasion that'll be happening in the game. So by default, most of the time you would have your MobiGas, unless, you know, we could think of some good reason to take it away for you for whatever reason.
Delta Mike would like to ask if ships will have a logbook.
A logbook.
Like a logbook as in, like, landed on this planet, took off, took on so many goods, sold this, that kind of stuff?
Yeah, I think that sort of thing.
It's not in the design currently, so it's not necessarily something that's particularly hard. It's really just a matter of, like, I think that falls in the case of a feature that, like, down the road we may implement, but it's not top of the priority of what we want to implement right now.
For multi-monitors, will people be able to customize their HUD, kick some of the data out to the monitors on the side, that sort of thing? That fall into the same as the second.
We've actually already been doing some coding to handle multiple monitors, mm-hmm. right? So
yeah, the HUD is split up into a number of parts so that we can stretch it out to make sure it fits on whatever aspect ratio you might have. And that'll definitely give you some extra screen real estate to show a little more information.
Yeah, so I mean, not so much of like saying this part's on this monitor and this part's on this monitor for the reasons that Zane talked about, but definitely it will handle things like Eyefinity or wider displays. So it sort of dynamically adjusts to your aspect ratio or larger screen area or a larger field of view.
Can your HUD suffer damage during combat?
Yeah, actually, there was a little clip of some of the damage state in that we've designed in the video that preceded this. There'll definitely be damage reflected in the HUD. The HUD may reflect damaged individual components as well.
Right, and then you've got, okay. since we have all these systems that interact with each other, if a system goes down, it won't be feeding the display on the HUD, and the HUD just won't
right.
be connected to seeing the weapons or whatever.
You'll lose elements of your HUD if you... Because all the systems are real and can take damage, you might lose your radar or your targeting computer.
Right, and they're all dynamic. They all talk to each other via an event system. So, mm-hmm. yeah, there's nothing. It's basically a messaging system inside the ship that talks, and so the items talk to the displays and tell them information. Mm-hmm. And if the item goes away, then they won't be getting information display. Right. That'll go away. So we kind of coded a whole system for the displays and the ship systems that way to make it. To like, hopefully, it will feel like a real, living, breathing vehicle. And when things go down, they go down on your display. We don't have to really do any special coding; it falls out of the system.
Right.
Can users turn off their HUDs, like in the end of Star Wars?
That should probably be something they can do.
Yeah. I mean, I have a problem. You definitely be able to minimize stuff, but I guess if you want to, turn it off and use the force, go ahead.
Take some pretty screenshots.
Be really good, though. Some confusion over what the HUD actually is. Is it projected on your helmet? Is it in the glass cockpit? What do you actually have to be wearing to see your HUD in your ship?
So the HUD, specifically in the Hornet, because it will vary on ships, is a combination. So some of it is projected on your visor. Some of it will be projected in the space of your cockpit in front of you. So basically anything that would be specific to the orientation of your ship itself would probably be projected into the cockpit space, and stuff that's information that you would do. So like targeting information or whatever, looking around, will probably be on your visor, but we don't have it working here. But in the prototype I had, like, there was a, you know, pretty standard sort of play, like a, you know, horizon line setup. And that was actually projected in sort of the front projecting, which you can already see in the Hornet right now. You can see these sort of little devices to project. And I think right now there's sort mm-hmm. of a translucent kind of plane sitting in front of you. And that's really where the spatial projection would be for the stuff that was fixed to the Hornet. And it would be a combination depending on what makes sense. It's kind of confusing if you have like a horizon line or a heading thing that, like, it needs to stay with the orientation of the ship, not with which way you're looking. Mm-hmm. But some stuff would naturally go with where you were looking, like targeting reticles or information for that. So the answer is a combination.
Okay. Guys, got some more HUD questions for us? Zane and Chris and Brennan? Wondering if we could talk about the command module on some of the larger ships. Will that be the same sort of HUD interface, or will that be something else?
Well, the same system.
Private. I'm not sure it's going to look necessarily the same. I mean, there's a differentiation between, like, the display and the input to the actions, but the way we're designing the system is that the HUD system itself is meant to be pretty modular. So, you know, we could have a specific look and functionality that you see in the Hornet that would be very different than what you'd see, say, in the Constellation or what you could see in the Idris Corvette, although they'll be all using the same basic system. That's why we have the ability to drive this feature. In this seat, you're only doing weapons control. In this seat, you're flying it or whatever. You know, we probably would, like, you know, in the bigger ship, the command and control, you would have some of the stuff you see now, but you'd also have, like, a big sort of floating, you know, hologram of, like, you could see situational sort of setup of all the different ships in the theater of operation you're in, and maybe you can click on it and sort of say, okay, and direct this ship to attack that ship, and so it's sort of like a big holosphere. So not too dissimilar than what you would, you know, you've seen in, haven't seen Ender's Game, but I bet you they have something like that in Ender's Game. Prometheus has something pretty similar to it, that kind of stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I imagine the interfaces would be sort of specialized based on kind of what function you're actually doing in the ship. Like if you're a weapons commander, you know, whatever function you're doing, you have a specialized interface for that with the manufacturer language, the visual language applied to it.
Wondering if space weather, you know, electromagnetic interference, nebula, that sort of thing will affect the HUD. Are we going to brown out, be disabled by certain types of space?
That's a good question. That's a cool idea to fill around.
The answer is yes. It's part of the design. So the display will get affected, could get interference, could go off altogether. Depends on where you are, what the environment would be. So there may be some nebulas you go into that you basically are running blind, essentially. Not too dissimilar than today's world. If you're in an aircraft, mm-hmm. and you get caught in an electrical storm.
User's wondering about a third-person HUD.
Yeah, there's not going to be.
You know, the only third-person HUD would be looking back at your guy and seeing some HUD being projected, like I said, in the Iron Man style. But that's not useful for you. There won't be. You can't go to a chase view. And have all that extra peripheral vision and have all the same HUD information. I mean, that's kind of immersion breaking. So, you know, when we go to a chase view, you go to a view that would be like a chase planes view versus. So I don't know if that was someone that wanted to have the third person HUD or not have a third person HUD, but we won't have a third person HUD in the, you know, in the tradition of a, you know, kind of a more sort of arcadey shooter up setup.
Let's see. Any more HUD questions, folks? Will there be electronic warfare that specifically targets other users' HUDs? That's a good question.
There's definitely going to be electronic warfare. I mean, that's already designed in.
So there's the idea of EMP, there's your radar. We have a whole set of the radars themselves. There's multiple kinds of signatures you look for. You can look for heat, you can look for reflective signature, electromagnetic signature, and there will be different things that you can do to counter them or shield against them or protect them. How well you can track those depends on how quickly your missile can lock or all the above. So if you're running a stealth ship, you know, you may be almost impossible to target with a missile. You may have to take out with your guns and get on their tail. So that's all adds into the idea of a lot of sort of rock, paper, scissors, give and take in the space combat.
I think they're imagining some kind of electronic pulse missile I fire, and it just knocks out your HUD for 30 seconds.
Yeah, 100%. That's basically the, like, we already have them in our specs. So we have EMP mines. I think we have EMP missiles.
We have energy draining weapons and
energy generating weapons. So a lot of, we have stuff that would basically affect yourself. I mean, that's the beauty of having a procedural system. Like,
Now, you could overload someone with too much heat, which could fry their systems. You could overload them with a big EMP pulse, bring down their electronics. All our stuff works in that, like, if we take away power or we do something like that, all the systems would just go out automatically.
Mm-hmm.
That's how it would work. So we probably have to have some, like, shutdown states or whatever animations.
A lot of
that.
Available right now, so get them quickly.
Ready to crash the website again.
Yes, let's see if the website can stay up to this one.
Hey, we checked with...
I think
Ben was on. So, Ben, we weren't meant to say that because
the website crashed.
Ah, well, we may have just crashed Rooms it again. So far, so good.
Where are we at with Dan? Because I think we're coming up to that section, right? Right near the end.
Can I have the thumb drive?
So so basically I can't plug it into the live system, right?
Okay, well the addresses are sold out, so I guess we...
Oh, so there we go.
Well, they were sold out before you made the announcement. But
yeah, such a tease, Ben.
Yeah.
That's not very nice.
I blame Eric. There will be another 11 addresses later, not during the stream,
so watch for that if you really, really want one. Let's go back to HUD questions. Will the HUD tie into the organization system for organizing your squadron, interacting with your group members?
Well, definitely, like,
HUD will tie in, and the displays will tie into the organization stuff, which is essentially how we're managing your friends and who you talk to. So, you know, I guess we in the game look at the organization system as sort of channels, essentially. So, you know, you can have your channel for this guild or this channel for this friends list or whatever. And that will all be accessible via the HUD, the display systems, when you're outside your ship, from your Mobi glass, and so on.
Let's see. HUD questions, folks. Let's see. Can we expect random failure of systems?
I don't know. What do you think?
I don't know. I mean, things might wear out over time, but that's sort of reflected as that's sort of a damage failure if it's just worn out. I don't think random.
Yeah, I don't think we got the idea that, like, you get. Well, I mean, we definitely have the red ring of death, right? So if you overheat your system, it'll take it down. But I don't think we have, like, a random dice roll. Roll, and if you're, you know, you go snake eyes, your ship's HUD goes down or anything.
There's players wondering about color blindness and HUDs.
Yeah, so that's one of the things I addressed in sort of, like, the color customization, is that, you know, some people, I mean, there's a lot more people that are color efficient than you might think. The primary one is between the colors red and green, at least differentiating between those colors. So, I mean, and also some people might have trouble reading red elements on a black background. So the thing I talked about, like the critical alert that's red, it's by default in red, but that's customizable. So you can assign a different color to it, But for the most part, like the HUD is actually, like, pretty uniform in color.
Wondering about customizable displays in the Hornet, what they can display on them.
So in the Hornet, like some of the displays, there's the physical displays in the Hornet, and they display information too. But the idea is that you can take information on those physical displays in the Hornet and project it onto your HUD. So things like some of the different displays will display different categories of information. So, for example, like one category is your weapon systems and your ship systems. But you can actually take whatever is on those Hornet screens and
have it mapped to your HUD. And then you can actually have tabs in your HUD that you can cycle through to pop out different information streams, which I think was shown in the preview, but I'm not sure.
Preview, but that's definitely part of the design. You should be, like, you can set your, this is the weapons display, this is the ship status display, and you should be able to pull them up and transfer them to your HUD and put the monitors away. That's kind of the idea. And that's generally the idea of all the ships. I think the Hornet's probably got the most displays in it because, again, it's a dedicated dogfighting military ship. Whereas something like, say, even the 300i or the Constellation is not quite the same. So it's more about, okay, well, I'll put it up on my HUD or I'll put it down on my one display, but it's not so focused on having so many displays giving you so much information at one time. Because it's really just a sort of matter of what roles you'll use it for.
Wondering if the HUD can be
upgraded, like a ship component.
Yeah, so most definitely that's part of the design right there. We're going to be able to upgrade it. So, like,
just general things like, at the lowest level, like targeting computer, you can maybe only target one target at a time. You get the upgrade, you could have two or three or four targets, simultaneous targeting, simultaneous locking. And the same on the HUDs, so we're going to allow you to have upgrades on the HUDs that maybe give you, more information or a different kind of information. So all our items, including sort of the internal ones, like the avionics ones, all generally are designed to have multiple levels to them. So, maybe a more advanced one would allow a higher level of customization than the basic one would. Mm-hmm.
Question, are you intending the HUD to make up for visibility issues in some of the ships, or is that something that will be addressed in the future?
That's probably related to the Hornet canopy and the feeling like the struts of the canopy are too big. So we may do a little bit of work on, what's that?
There's the freelancer has the thing in the middle, and they have something about it.
I'm just saying, if people go back to last year, and they look at the hey, let's make this a big bubble canopy so you have better visibility. Everyone wanted to lynch poor Jim Martin, who was the conceptual designer, and us for doing it. And so we changed it back to the concept art, and now there's massive threads bitching that there's no visibility. But, I'm just saying. Can never win in that situation. But on a dogfighting one, it's more important than, say, something like the Freelancer, which is less focused on dogfighting. But there's a dynamic look system that I talked about in the beginning of this live stream that we haven't shown yet. That's still, it's part of this unified first look. But essentially the idea behind it is that when you're in the cockpit, just like in real life, your focus is dynamically changing. So if I'm looking at something outside the cockpit, say I'm not looking like down in my close proximity, but outside, say a ship I'm trying to trail, what happens is the field of view will narrow down and my focus will sort of basically be shifted in that direction. So essentially what will happen is, what right now, because we have a very wide field of view right now because it's sort of basically trying to be wide so you can look down and see your legs in the cockpit and generally the cockpit and then look up. But if you're actually chasing a ship and focusing on them, you're just by human nature, you just generally tend to tunnel vision. And so we're going to dynamically do that. As you look around, depending on what you're focusing on, we're actually going to be casting a ray out from the eye and seeing what you're focusing on, and we're going to be changing the field of view. So if you're focusing and looking at something outside your cockpit will probably go more out of focus and your field of view will narrow. When you come back down to look inside your cockpit, it will be a wider field of view and things outside will be out of focus, but things inside will be. And that's sort of a dynamic look system. And I think that will help with some of the visibility issues. Obviously, a HUD is there to give you sort of increased situational awareness, and obviously it uses part of that. And then again, like I said, there will be some ships that some work, like, you know, the Hornet canopy will probably do a bit of work on to reduce the size of the struts. But I think when it's all put together, it will all feel pretty awesome and pretty immersive.
Be patient, everybody. People are wondering if they can upgrade their HUD from one ship to another. So if they like the 300i HUD, can they port it over to the Hornet or vice versa?
That's a good question. We sort of, we talked about making them ship specific.
The other option would be HUDs could be, you know, like manufacturer specific. There's, you know, the equivalent of GE makes this HUD and Samsung makes this HUD kind of thing. So we haven't really decided that. So I don't know. I'm not sure you can take your Anvil Hornet HUD and plug it into the 300i because there's some specific stuff for the Hornet HUD that is for the Hornet versus the 300i. But we may have some more sort of generic manufacturers that, you know, is maybe a more consistent interface across the ships. The system will definitely handle it. It's just a matter of, because the HUD and the information display is all handled in vehicle items, and they completely are not, they're not locked to the ship. So just the same way, like if you're in the hangar, you can move guns back and forth. Well, basically everything, thrusters, any avionics package, heat coolers, batteries, power plants, all of that are essentially items that will dynamically swap, and you can plug into different ships. Now, some ships won't accept a certain kind of item or whatever, but generally there's nothing in the system that is like hard-coded to one specific ship. It's very data-driven.
All right. Let's see. One user would like to know what your favorite ship is, Chris.
Well, it would probably be the Constellation. And I'm working very hard right now, actually, to get the instance physics working, which we have a prototype of, whereby, you know, you're flying the ship around and all that works perfectly in its own physical world, but you're in another physical world, i.e. the global space. And that's all working then. That's the awesome in the ship dogfighting, getting in the gunner's turret, fighting while someone else is flying it, while someone's, you know, trying to take you out in their Hornet or 300i or whatever. So I would say the Constellation's kind of my favorite, just because it gives you that promise. It's like an experience that I haven't seen at that level of fidelity in the game. And then I think probably my second favorite is the Hornet. I mean, I really like the Hornet. It feels solid and like a great sort of military dogfighter. And some of the stuff, you know, some of the tweaks and upgrades we've done are really nice for it. And so I'm just looking forward to, you know, seeing all these things that we're sort of, I don't know, like 70-80% of the way there all come together. So like of all the fidelity and the touches, and have a full-on dogfight without going, oh, there's a graphical glitch here, or oh, there's a crash here, because my sense is it's just going to feel really like good and solid and fun.
Let's see. Can the dynamic field of view be turned off?
We'll probably allow that to be turned off. I mean, it's just one of those things we won't force you to do it, but that'll be sort of the one that would be
the full one.
Let's see. When are we going to hear more about the Origin 890? Coming up.
Yeah,
I would say next year when we'll show you what it looks like. So we gotta save some stuff for next year. It's like you know, we gotta pace ourselves here.
Yeah, you have to remember you're just unlocking these ships now, and now they go to design and then art, and you'll follow the process until you'll
see them as they're developed.
Bring Bad Bad to talk about this.
It's not.
Oh, go on. You can ask that question.
I was just going to say that.
I think we were going to show a little bit of fun thing that we've got playing around. We use it internally for like our balancing and testing, and this is something that Eric hinted at that we're going to put in the hangar, not tomorrow, but hopefully by the end of the year, so people can have some fun.
Hey,
so I haven't actually I can see this.
Sit by Brendan.
I think you'll be in the shot if you sit by Brendan. So we see it all upstairs, but we don't have a way of actually demoing it live because of the way we're set up here. So you're on the mic.
Yep.
But this is, you just captured this from your machine upstairs, right?
Yes,
so we thought
now.
This would be kind of fun. All right. So we're gonna play this, you're gonna talk us through it. How does this work?
Sure, absolutely.
He can talk through while you play
right.
it.
go ahead and run the video. So how it's set up here is we have the Gatling gun that's hooked up onto the Hornet that we're setting up for Dogfight V1. You can see the scale of the thing is just massive. So we got our test weapon mount here. So I'm getting into the chair right now where you can actually just interact with it. It's going to swivel out for you and you can actually jump in. It's going to pull you back in. And this whole thing is now like a whole firing range for you guys. So we just set this up so you can actually shoot at all these different targets. So a lot of these are all set up thanks to Forrest as well for and Zane for these guys actually setting this target up real fast for us. So I got the Gatling gun, but also the best part about this whole thing is with the stuff that we have in the hangar, that whole holo table, you can actually swap out the guns. So here, check this out. So if you guys are all familiar with the holo table, you can actually pull in the weapon mount itself and then go over to the weapons table over here. I'm going to pull over one of the other, actually the laser repeater, and I'll plug that in. And then you can see it's actually swapped the actual mount and the weapon itself on the mount. And then that'll completely switch out the actual weapon that's available. And now you can actually shoot that one too. So it completely changes the effect, changes everything. So it's just demoing off exactly like what the weapons are going to be capable. And I was using this test platform actually to test out like the Hornet destructibility. And of course, totally fixed up yet, but at least from here, you can actually test out all the different weapons that that we're actually going to be pumping out for Dogfight. So thanks a lot, Zane. Thanks a lot, Forrest, for rapidly helping us out with this.
Cool. Well, that's so yeah. So we're gonna get you guys a weapon test platform. We may even do a thruster firing thing. And we may have a few more surprises for the firing range stuff that
we're
thinking about, but we won't quite do that yet. So we'll let you. So basically, even if you're not getting a dogfight in the next few weeks, you can blow things up.
Exactly.
And it's kind of cool. So. So it's what?
Skype had stopped recording.
But we're good here, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, the Skype's fine. That's fine. Okay, right.
Perfect.
So anyway, yeah. So I hope you like that. So I guess should we want to take a couple of questions for Dan on the firing thing?
Sure.
Why not? If
go
we
ahead.
Can.
Yeah,
anybody
has questions
about the firing range? Ask him in the chat room.
So of course, also with the firing range, like. That was just a basic mock-up.
What I wanted to do later on is like have it so that like different targets would pop up and then you would actually have to aim and shoot at those different ones. So that was just a quick mock-up of what we currently had.
Will there be a railgun? Well, yeah, there will be a railgun. I mean, that's actually one of the gun types that we have. I'm not sure there's going to be a railgun in the next week or so. I mean, generally our big railguns are all big
cap
stuff.
Ship, yeah.
So you won't be able to mount that in your hangar, else you blow your hangar out.
Right.
I have a question.
I'm wondering about using their handheld weapons in the firing range.
That's also something.
We're not ready to show you that, but we're actually making really good progress on that stuff. And so we'll have a future update on that. But yeah, I mean, we're that stuff's actually quite easy because you got a lot of that out of the box, and we're actually doing some really cool additional stuff for zero G and a bunch of other stuff. But that's a kind of future update. But that was when I was saying at the top of the live stream that, you know, because we've had such great funding, I've been able to go wider than I thought we would do sooner. So we're going to be able to. Be delivering stuff for people to play around and enjoy for the next year.
And weapons.
Crossbow. Yes, crossbow. We're doing with
crossbow. Oh, my stream is weak.
All right. Weapons testing. Will there be unlimited ammo for the ballistics weapons in the testing range? People are already worried about that.
Yeah, we're not that. We're not that cruel. No, I think you would. I think you. Although, to another thing that we haven't talked about, but there's ammo boxes. So, like, basically, everything's. So, like, ballistic weapons have hard ammunition, and they have limited amounts of ammunition. Energy weapons are different. That they draw from the power, so they basically have unlimited ammunition, but they can overheat, and there's some other issues that go with those. And ballistic ammunition has a better ability to penetrate shields than, say, energy weapons do. So there's give and take, but the system is actually, the Gatling gun is an example, that's actually got a ammo case on
exactly.
it that yeah. has a certain amount, and we will have gameplay in the game where, like, on the, say, like, on a bigger cap ship or something, you will actually have to go and
retrieve it from your storage
exactly.
and then actually load it into the actual ammo container.
Yeah.
And even the weapons test platform completely is set up to automatically kind of handle that with the ammo boxes that are currently on it. Because there's a secondary ammo box that's attached to the weapon mount already that you have to actually, well, currently we have it set up so that you have to manually just press a button and it'll load the next ammo box for you. But for the unlimited ammo bit, like we'll definitely probably make that available for you guys. As well with the weapon test platform, we have it respecting all the pipe systems. So the idea is so that you can actually test it out versus like different reactors, different heating, or sorry, different coolers, and all just basically testing out all those different weapons and how they would actually affect your different pipe systems. So as soon as we get all that displays up and running with Brendan as well as Zane, so we're actually going to be able to display all that stuff for you guys. So then that way you guys can actually like theorycraft on to what weapon and what coolers and everything can actually be more or less effective. And then you guys can have fun with that.
Great. Any other ammo or weapons range questions, folks? Can we test the tractor beam?
Not yet.
Not
really,
yet.
So.
Yeah.
I'm actually not sure we've coded the tractor beam yet, actually.
No,
so.
I don't think so.
I mean, it's not particularly difficult to code, but I don't think we've done the effect for the tractor beam or coded it, but that will be happening. I mean, the whole mining side of things is something that that's a whole gameplay mechanic that we've got a pretty good idea of what to do, but we've got to actually do the implementation of it. But
exactly.
I think it'll be kind of cool.
So as soon as that weapon comes online, we could attach it to the weapon platform.
Yep. Yeah, so I mean, that's the nice thing, right? Is the nice thing about having the weapon platform there is you will be able to like play around with some of the weapons and swap them out, and then obviously, and then just to give everyone a heads up, the way that we're thinking about the dogfight is that, you know, your hangar is your base for the dogfight, and that's where you basically specify the loadout of what you want on your ship before you're going to fly in the dogfight.
Exactly.
Then you climb into your ship and you sort of turn simulation mode on, and the outside of the hangar sort of disappears, and now you're in space and you're flying around. And we got some cool stuff that we're going to show for the space stuff, but not quite yet because we've got a bunch of little graphical things that we want to make perfect. But I'm hoping in the next three, like before the end of the year, we'll have actually some like pretty cool stuff to show. Definitely got some, I mean, like a lot of the stuff's all there, but it's a matter of like getting the final visual of like, we got some really great explosion tech. We got some great shield tech, nebula tech. Asteroids. So we're it's gonna it's hopefully you guys are gonna like it. It's gonna be pretty cool. I think we're kind of at our end now, right? 3:00.
Yeah.
We got an explosion.
What, explode
how
me?
How do you feel a year later?
Yeah.
After that crazy 24-hour live stream.
Can you sum up the year of StarCitizen?
Amazing would be the one word. If you think about it, like this time last year, I think we were at 6.8 million. I think the live stream ended at 6. On the morning of the 19th, I believe it's 6.2, and then there was another 600,000 over like the week or so afterwards because there was Thanksgiving and of course a website crash. So we gave everyone some grace period. So we could clean it all up because the old system we had was not particularly well designed for the level of support that we were enjoying, which was pretty awesome.
So yeah, I mean, it's amazing. I mean, like, what? I don't even know where we're at now. 32 and
we were past 9.
So, okay, so basically 32 and a half. So, yeah, that's crazy, right? So that's 25, almost 26 yeah. million dollars.
Almost 1.5 in the last day.
Yeah, so so thank you all. It's amazing. I mean, the and it's not you know, it's not the end of the ride, because we're kind of just beginning. So I have to say that for me, this process, as you're doing it and involving everyone and sharing it and showing it, I think one of the reasons why, you know, we're at the level we are and everyone's still so enthusiastic is you don't feel like this isn't like something that's finite that you're buying, that you're just going in and buying like a, you know, a $50 or $60 game and that's it, and it's an experience you're going to play for a week or so. It sort of feels like it's a world that you're going to go and spend many years in. And I think that, or at least I feel like a lot of you out there are feeling like it's great fun to be involved in it this early, to sort of have your voices heard, see how it's happening, and feel like you're part of the team. And we certainly on our side like it on our, because we sort of, it's, you know, it's great to have this many people be into it so early, but also just from the feedback side point. I mean, it's like, it's great for us to do stuff and see what people like, what people don't like, what works, what doesn't. I mean, definitely the game design has evolved based on the community. I mean, for like, you know, I keep talking about it, but there's lots of extra things that I didn't realize people wanted to do, as many diverse roles in the universe as they do. And I think that's completely cool. And, you know, we're designing a sandbox anyway, so why not allow all these different roles to be there? And I think that's sort of adding to kind of the way people are sort of viewing this as like a destination to spend a lot of time in. And so it's cool. So I'm actually looking forward to next year more. I mean, this last year was amazing, but next year a lot of the stuff we've been working on and setting up is essentially going to be paying off, and I think everyone's going to be really excited. I mean, I'm very confident that we're going to do something that's pretty amazing, and it's going to be a place I just want to adventure around. I'm just really curious to see what everyone's going to do, and yeah, it's going to be awesome. So that's my summation, and I really appreciate, and everyone here on the team completely appreciates your support and dedication and enthusiasm, and we won't let you down. Don't worry about it.
The chat role indicates
they think you should be offering a letter right now.
All right. Well, I would like to say thank you to everyone that's been here on the live stream. We'll put up some of these videos on our YouTube channel so you can sort of enjoy them. And I guess I've got a $32 million thank you letter to finish up. And thank you for all your time and patience and support. And you are the best damn community ever.